Saturday Night Virus begins now.
This is as disorganized as it comes.
Aye, are you ready, laddies? Stop fiddling with your tiny pricks.
So you're smoking crack at
it was actually underneath the Brooklyn Bridge.
Of course it was.
Opie and Anthony present.
I had a piece of cardboard and a boombox, and I was backspinning.
For one night only.
So I have this theory that when you're jerking off, it's like a kaleidoscope in your mind.
But doesn't a kaleidoscope...
You mean like a Viewmaster,
maybe a Viewmaster kaleidoscope. It's all the same.
The Lazlow Show.
This ain't Little House on the Prairie.
Starring Big Wayne.
You banged a homeless girl, Wayne?
Yeah, she lived in a car. She wasn't homeless.
Reed Tucker.
I blacked out for like the last 5 minutes. I don't even know what... Is this a radio show still?
And Lazlow.
As we all know, when it's time to negotiate with an art dealer, it's time to whip out your junk.
One show, fighting to show them we're no dogs, but men. Men who remember freedom, which 16-year-olds can drink and listen to metal music and smoke at bars and get into high-speed accidents. Men who have punch cards at Planned Parenthood. This is the Lazlow Show.
Take it wrong town, get on the band. Take it wrong town.
Show episode 31. We will call this the white girls on YouTube episode. Tonight on the show, mashups of McCain, Hillary, and Obama, Gary Coleman's penis, some rap from Belgium, retarded policemen. We find out why hip hop is dead. We'll hear some more from our producer Reed, who has failed to get a guest for the show, about how he thinks scientists are stupid and rich religious fanatics and oil executives are smart. DJ Jaguar Skills will be checking in from London, but we'll start this off with a new mashup from DJ Lobster Dust. The name is It's Fun to Smoke Dust, and it's putting Queen with some audio of a televangelist.
Damien, the omen, because you're the devils, you're the demons, and you know that. Your music, rock and roll, is a satanic music. When they say you turn around, you make the music go black, and you hear Satan speaking. You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking. You make the music go black, you hear Satan make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking. You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking. You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking. You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking. You make the music go black, you make the music go black, you make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking.
Today message is solemn for young people who listen to rock and roll and heavy metal music. Satan knows he only has a short time to deceive the earth, so he's using music as his antichrist tool to deceive the masses.
You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking.
And I'm finally beginning to unravel a bizarre and fiendish plot designed by Satan's antichrist system to corrupt, pervert, and ultimately enslave the youth of this generation.
Another one bites the dust.
You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking.
Satan's satanic takeover of our youth through rock music.
You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking.
All rock music is dangerous. I want to tell you that today, even some of the mellow stuff that doesn't sound like it has anything in it that could be deceptive or even misleading. I started asking God, can you show me how he's doing it? I wanted to have proof positive. Now, Queen has a song called
Another One Bites the Dust.
We have the same reaction the first service. The kids went, oh no, not Queen. Not Another One Bites the Dust.
Another One Bites the Dust.
All rock music is dangerous.
Another One Bites the Dust.
I want you to know today that Satan has planted his lyrics in the music, and some of it is subliminal. That means it's down at low decibel levels where you wouldn't hear it audibly as you play the music at the speed that you, or the high sound levels that you would regularly play it.
You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking.
Satan has planted his lyrics in the music.
You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking.
There's another message going on below the surface. This is called subliminal programming.
You make the music go black, you hear Satan speaking.
But I want to say something. I don't believe that this particular masking was intentional. I think that this is something that Satan himself put into the music. Let's play it forwards. Another One Bites the Dust.
Another one bites the dust. Another one busts the dust. Ow! Another one busts the dust. Hey, hey! Another one busts the dust. Hey!
for you backwards. It's the next cassette. We'll have to put a new cassette in. And on this next cassette, I want you to hear the secret message. It's over and over and over. It says, it's fun to smoke marijuana. It's fun to smoke marijuana. It's fun to smoke marijuana. You listen to it and tell me if it's not there. Let's play that. You see what the secret message was? It's fun to smoke marijuana. It's fun to smoke marijuana. It's fun to smoke marijuana. Now I'm gonna play that backwards for you once more for those of you that are skeptics.
Lazlow Show, episode 31. We call it the White Girls on YouTube episode, which we'll find out why very soon. But we should do a quick roundup of exactly what this show is. We have Big Wayne, who's a carpenter from Queens. He used to rob shoe stores. We've got Reed, who has been unemployed for the better part of his life. Uh-huh. Was in Grand Theft Auto 3 with me back in 2001 and has written a couple of articles and books that didn't really sell very well. And he's also known as the useless producer. We did the show on K-Rock for several months every week, and they offered us a full-time gig, and we turned it down. And instead, every now and then, we do the Lazlow Show thanks to Opie and Anthony.
Yeah, man.
So, but Reed normally books the guests, and I'll have to say I came pretty correct last time. I got us like Mr. Big Shot Saturday Night Live in our show last month. And Reed, I talked to him on Thursday and say, I'm quite nervous you haven't gotten a guest. He's like, dude, we have plenty of time. So, and so who's going to be on the show tonight, Reed?
Yeah, they all fell through.
Yeah, good. Good.
I tried. We went through. This is the most guests I've ever gone through.
Right.
And this is you can't just get anyone up in here.
Yeah, I've gotten, in fact, we'll have a special guest a little bit later. So
we have standards.
Right.
You can't just get any of those assholes who are standing out in Times Square asking you if you like to laugh.
But Reed, between shows, you have about 30 days. Thursday is 2 days before the show, don't you think?
No, I didn't start Thursday.
Oh, okay. When did you start? Friday morning.
Monday.
Lazlow told you Thursday.
Monday.
And I have to say, it's like this show starts about an hour beforehand when we're at the Noodle House, where we always go. And Wayne is quite a loud gentleman. I might add that Wayne was so drunk after the last show, we were on the train, he was an embarrassment. He was a fucking... he was slurring, and he was...
I was commenting on women on the train.
Yeah, he was commenting on women with their boyfriends right there. And then he tells the guy, enjoy it while it lasts, because after a while, the erectile dysfunction and everything kicks out. I'm like, dude, please, you're going to get me beat up.
Well, if you're riding the train to Long Island at 3 a.m., though, you got to expect a little bit of that, don't you think?
Yeah, the Guidos are drunk.
Well, he drank half a bottle of rum.
Yeah, he did drink that 120 proof rum, which we got a lot of email from fans of the show saying that they went and tried Ray and Nephew.
Did they really?
Yes, they did.
Wow.
And we got a bunch of email about Reed that we'll get to as well. But
why? What do I do?
Just about some of your musical choices.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
But this show starts about an hour beforehand. We were so loud in the Noodle House, and there was these five hens next to us at the table that looked like that nobody banged them in college. So they still get together and cackle. They were just cackling. And at one point, I don't know how the conversation happened, but you mentioned that Reed is...
That my wife actually thinks Reed's attractive.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
Look at me. Look how excited he gets.
Come on. I got to take what I can get.
So, yeah, because she always sticks up for you when
we beat you up.
I appreciate
that. And you say you haven't seen pussy so long you throw stones at it. So, he asked. You actually asked Wayne quite loudly if you could bang his...
No, he said, can I masturbate on your wife?
Well, you gotta start easy. You can't just go in for the straight sex. No, I was feeling out your limits. And you said that you were fine with that.
I'm fine with
where
it.
Where do you draw the line?
You
where do
bring
you draw
something
line?
To the party, though.
Oh, I said... No, well, I think problem
not
is, his
jerk
problem
off
is
on you.
His problem is he can't bring anything to his own party, okay? You think he can come to your party and there will miraculously be chicks at it.
All right, what if everything is over a webcam? Are you okay with that?
I don't know. I'm fine with it, sure.
What are you doing?
You gotta supply some webcams, though.
What are you doing?
Yeah, Wayne's a little in the hole with this dealer, so you're gonna have to come up with some dough.
But, he said he's fine with everything, but then he ominously throws out there that I'm gonna owe him one down the road.
Right.
What am I gonna owe you?
You know, someday you might have a wife, and I might want to.
You're not, dude. If I ever get married, you're not even webcam banging her, dude.
When did this
ever.
Turn into the Lazlow swinger show?
Yeah, I know.
Exactly.
We're gonna
Yeah, and then we get on the topic of women, hairy women, and I say to Reed, I go, have you ever had a hairy nipple? And he said, absolutely.
Of course, who hasn't?
And then you and what background was she?
I think Italian.
Yes, it's the Italian girls. You said downstairs was something out of an Indiana Jones film.
It was, dude. It's like the Temple of Doom. But do you think they know? Like, if they have that one long hair coming out of their nipple, don't you think they would pull that out?
I don't know why. It's like when you see women with a long hair off their chin, it's like,
right.
Honey, would you fucking do something about
it's
that?
It's just one. It's not like a beard. Just pull that one.
Yeah.
I can't deal with that.
Or shave. Or stop doing whatever it is that gives you loads of testosterone.
Right. That's what we're saying, because Lazlo and I were saying, we're not very hairy, but some of these girls, they have, let's face it, they have more hair than us.
Yeah, I'm an embarrassment. The hair on my chest, it's this little patch. It's like when you see a black guy who has hair on his chest. It's like little watermelon seeds of hair. And it's just, it's impossible to be sexy. And then Reed starts talking about the hair on his nipples. This is in a restaurant.
Yes.
Who cares? It's a Japanese restaurant. No one speaks English in there.
Right.
I didn't understand
and so I
a
hand
word.
The guy the money, and I say, this better not get funneled to Falun Gong. And Reed goes, that's Chinese, jackass. Like Chinese, Japanese, whatever.
Well, I mean,
fuck.
If you're going to offend a whole race of people, you may as well get the reference.
They're
right,
all
dumbass.
Together on the Falun Gong thing.
No, I
see those fools giving me literature. I'm like, dude, let me explain something to you. We don't give a fuck about our own people. Do you think we give a fuck about you? I mean, look at New Orleans.
Right.
Do you think that in a country where something like that mess can happen, where people are pooping on themselves in a Superdome, that we give a fuck about what's going on over in China? Make our fucking iPods and be quiet.
Right. Especially when I'm late for the F train. That's really what I'm looking for is some literature on transcendental meditation in China.
Yeah, exactly.
But have you seen when those Falun Gong people, they decided that just shoving the literature in front of your face isn't enough. So what they're going to do is they're going to bring out the cage. Have you seen that?
Yes, and they do it in multiple places. I've seen it in Vancouver. I've seen it in L.A.
I kind of dig that.
Yeah, it's like an Asian girl in a cage. I thought it was some kind of like, you get $5 and you get to go in for a while. And
she was for sale.
See what you're doing.
Right.
Exactly.
My apartment does need to be cleaned. How much is she?
When you're done, can you please get some of my shirts laundered? That would be awesome.
Yes.
And I do have to say, thanks to Danny. He always helps us out on this show every week, except I always get a call from Wayne, typically midweek after we've done a show, because he's listening to Opie and Anthony, and he's like, wow, there's a clip that we played on our show, and Danny took... Which is cool because sometimes, sometimes Opie will say, hey, here's something that Lazlo found. I've stopped hearing those little bits. It's Danny trying to be better than E-Rock and Than and everybody. Like he's the superstar.
That's not true.
It's not true.
I always give credit to this show when you guys give me something.
How about the molestation song?
You got full credit.
Did I?
The first time we played it, absolutely. The second and third time, probably not. But
must have been listening to the second and the third time.
You must have been, because believe me, I handed that in with a fucking big. It was big loose leaf paper. It said from Lazlo.
Okay.
Believe me, you got full credit for that. I wouldn't miss you guys.
Yeah.
I'm not a scumbag like Eric.
Okay. Wow. There's a lot of E-Rock bashing going on at dinner.
What?
So there was a lot of E-Rock bashing going on at dinner.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, exactly. Dude, I was driving to this dog training thing this morning. Have you seen these New York plates that say DDS on it? Like, dentists have their own vanity plates?
Yeah.
Now, I can understand if it's a doctor and it, you know, and a doctor's driving really fast down the parkway. It's like, all right, he might be going to save a life. Where the fuck is a dentist going? What kind of information do you need conveyed that it's a, oh, that's a dentist, you know, better let him through?
Well, it's just a prestige thing, you know. People want to let you know that they make a lot more money than you by defrauding Medicare.
Exactly.
But there's some women out there who probably fuck you because you're a dentist. Not that
Dude,
you
that's
are
so
a dentist,
nasty. They've got their fist in somebody's mouth all day.
Maybe they have an oral fetish.
I don't know.
Come on, dentists make a lot of money, man. They have access to
I'll tell you
nitrous.
Why they make a lot of money. I pay for health insurance for dental coverage. It covers like a toothbrush and a teeth cleaning. Everything on top of that, I'm spending $800 fucking dollars.
I got the same plan.
What are you getting done in there? You got dentures?
Dude, anything you do, like dental coverage is bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
It's bullshit. And so this is the health hour with...
yeah, right.
Yeah, exactly.
You want to give out the phone number?
Oh, yeah, I should do that. It's 1-866-WOW-1-WOW, 1-866-WOW-1-WOW. It is the Lazlow Show. I should mention that this show, we put them on our website, Lazlow.com, and, which is Lazlow, and you can actually pick up a box set of all the previous shows that we've done. And the last show we did is posted there in MP3 form. But the reason that I called this the White Girls on YouTube episode is... I love how these video sharing sites like YouTube have turned into the land of the teenagers, like, fronting on the playground to each other. You know what I mean? Where they're doing, like, responding to each other's videos. Oh, you're a bitch and all that kind of shit. And I saw this one that this cute teenage girl looks like she might, you know, sometimes have pigtails, looks honest and innocent. And has the mouth like she grew up in South Central. And I love how young white youths from, you know, $100,000 plus households like to sound like they're the downtrodden, been beat down. And, you know, I might have to shaft you at our private school bathroom. But I found this girl on YouTube this week.
What up, y'all? This is your girl, Lil J, and this little girl right here is getting a belt body. So if you got anything to say to me, you can say it to my motherfucking face, or send me a mother, or hit me up on my motherfucking MySpace.
You can say it to my face, or you can hit me up on my motherfucking MySpace.
Yeah, if you dare.
Right.
If you want to keep it real.
But isn't saying it to your face and saying it to you on MySpace a little different?
Maybe to her, it's exactly the same.
On my motherfucking MySpace, I did, and this little bitch right here will fucking kill your ass, nigga. So if you have anything to say, you can say it to me.
This is like...
She should have at least rehearsed the script a little more. If you're going to sound badass, don't you can't right. trip over your
and
words.
I tell you, when you look at her...
You can say it to me.
You look at her, she's a prim, proper, yuppie-looking girl. Who,
this is a white girl?
This is a white girl.
Oh, you had me fooled.
Wow.
You can say it to me. And if you want to bump, let's go. Because I ain't scared of your motherfucking ass. I bitch later.
That's hardcore.
We need to go break into her house and beat the shit out of her.
Dude, it is. And that's what people do. That's what drives me nuts about YouTube. Any comment, anything that you see on YouTube... There's always people, fake, and all these stupid, and then people arguing, you're a dumbass, what kind of education do you... The worst ones are political ones that have anything to do with, you know, because then you'll have, like, the Ron Paul people who are, you know, all upset, and then you'll have the pro-fucking-Hillary nutsos and the pro-McCain nutsos, and they're just battling. It's like, you know, I really want to make a difference in the world. Maybe I'll post some comments on a YouTube video.
Right.
You know?
That six people will watch.
Exactly.
Well, the actual presidential candidates ought to record their own, you know, back and forth with that shit.
Yeah, Obama could get on and be like, I'll fuck you up.
If you got anything to say to me, nigga, I will shiv your ass.
Shiv.
I forgot to mention, we might be getting a sponsor for the show.
Come on.
I swear to God, I got a call from one Will Chapman, who's Mr. Big Sales Guy at XM, and we might be getting a sponsor. And
sweet.
One of his first questions was, do you think you guys can actually do a show on a regular basis? And I was like, I don't know, dude.
Yeah. So will we have to plug something? Because that'd be pretty sweet. You know, we got to work something into everyday conversation on the show.
No, it wouldn't be like that. It wouldn't be like, wow.
Like a Ram truck.
Right.
And we all get one.
Yeah. Right, exactly.
Well, it should be liquor.
Yeah.
Don't you think that would work?
It's going to be something a bit dodgy. I already have
medical marijuana.
No, it's not. It's not medical.
This isn't California.
They need to calm that down, though. Like in California now, if people go to the doctor, they're like, "Yo, man, I think my neck hurts a little bit," and they're like, "Ah, oh, here you go, some script for White Widow number 5."
Right. They got vending machines now. I read. Have you heard that shit?
Vending machines for weed.
Come on,
I got to get out of here.
Dude, why are you not in California right now?
Seriously.
Man?
My boy here is a grand or two deep since January 1st.
Well, see, is it cheaper out there? Is the medical stuff cheaper than it's not?
No, it's pricey. Yeah. It's not inexpensive.
You gotta realize the government's running it.
Well, it's legal. I think what you're paying for is all the poor ass Mexican motherfuckers that get shot up in the gang wars down there. I mean, that's what you're paying for somebody to, you know, swallow a condom full of this stuff and bring it on an airplane.
Mm. I love swallowing condoms. Speaking of, have you seen any of these videos online or read about that crazy drug? It's called Salvia divinorum. Have you heard of it?
You lost me. What does that do?
It's a plant, and I mean, I heard about it years ago, but it supposedly has the effects of like severe LSD for about 5 or 10 minutes, and then it's over with.
Is it? And it's a pill?
No, it's a plant. You smoke it. You smoke it just like weed. And so... But speaking of kids posting videos, they're posting videos of themselves smoking it. And I saw this one that's absolutely hysterical. This guy, you know, sitting at his computer desk and decides to smoke it up.
All right, I am going to smoke some salvia in front of this camera so I can observe myself later. And if this trip is entertaining enough, perhaps I'll find stuff on YouTube or something. Hopefully my lighter will work because this is actually my second time trying to do this, so... Here we go.
So he lights it up and he stares at the he stares at the camera for about 60 seconds. He stares into space for about 60 seconds. And then all of a sudden he turns around and looks at the camera and jumps and screams, "Oh fuck."
Oh fuck. I forgot there was even a camera here. Wow, okay. It's affecting me right now. And it's weird. I can't even imagine that there's actually... Oh, yeah, there is the feeling. Yeah, okay. I remember this yesterday.
It sounds like he's getting a blowjob.
Yeah, but if you score some sweet-ass drugs, the last thing I want to do is sit in front of a webcam by myself in my bedroom. Like, don't these people have friends or somewhere to go?
If you're blacking out and you don't know what you're doing, I actually like his idea, you know?
Yeah.
He wants to know what the fuck happened to those 5 minutes.
Well, that's true. All right,
you got to understand, Wayne gets some mad nods every now and then.
I remember this yesterday. Okay, so I'm going to try really hard to look at this, all right? So there's the camera, and there's my hands. Fuck. Fuck. All right. Oh boy, I closed my eyes and there was like this big design. Okay. It's weird, this is weird. You can't even begin, everything feels nuts. I don't even know what's going on right now. This is, I can't even, I'm not controlling my hands. This is gonna be the best video ever, I can already tell because, I mean,
He goes on for like another 5 minutes about how his hands are fractals.
The best thing is, in 5 years, this asshole is going to try to get a job at Price Waterhouse Coopers, you know, or something.
What
and
is
they're
the
going to dial that shit.
Is it legal?
Salvia. It is legal.
How have you not done it?
Yeah, that's what I mean. I never heard of it. I'd like to check it out.
Oh, yeah, Wayne's getting old. Dude, shed a tear.
If I know people that have tried it.
Let's get a bud.
And if you want to smoke it on the air, we could maybe do a little experiment.
I'd like that.
But here's what worries me about it is that, so there's these sites where people post videos of themselves smoking it. Some people smoke it and then run out of the room. That kind of worries me because Wayne is like a 200 some odd pound guy, and I don't know if I could slow him down if he bugs out.
Let's let Wayne smoke it and then watch two girls in one cup, and then we'll film that.
What I find funny about that is that you're saying it lasts 5 minutes.
Yeah, it lasts like five to 10 minutes.
You've seen the way I smoke last, so it's like, that's going to last for like an hour or so, because I'm just going to keep smoking.
So, wait, is hallucinating, is that a plus for you?
No, the hallucinating is
then
a
what?
Plus, though.
So why do you want
to
do this?
Just to check it out.
What's the worst hallucination you ever had?
Mine?
Yeah, or...
The worst one that I ever had, I was running through a field on acid.
Wait, were you were?
Yeah, okay. And I thought the cops were after me, and then I tried to climb over a barbed wire fence, and that didn't go so well.
Jesus.
And then my legs were all ripped up, and then I went and laid in bed and sort of bled a little bit. But the other massive hallucination was the day that I graduated college. We were all sitting around in a room. We'd all taken ecstasy, and we're all sitting around in a room, and I looked over at my buddy, and he got up and he walked into the television, and I was so far gone that I was like, oh, that's cool. Tom wants to go be inside the TV for a while, because he just got sucked into it, and the TV wasn't even on.
Jesus.
And so then I'm sort of staring fast. When we're listening to some crazy Grateful Dead album or some, you know, it's an album of all drums in space for fucking 8 hours.
Given.
And so then I look over to my left, and there's Tom again. And I was like, oh, you're back. And he's like, I am? I said, yeah. I go, you stood up and you walked in into the television. He goes, I did? And I go, you sure did? And he's like, fuck, I did. It was... Yeah. And
that was just on ecstasy, though.
Yeah.
Huh?
And the best part was his girlfriend hid her tape recorder under the couch. Oof. So the next day, we listened to our conversations. Embarrassing, bro.
Yeah, what were you talking about? Just made no sense.
Some fool got up and got into the TV, and right. He was like, oh, I must like, have. I yeah. must have gotten sucked into
that
the...
makes complete sense.
Oh, look at this. Dude, every time we do a show, it turns into the drug hour
the
somehow. This is Ryan in Indiana. What's up?
Hey, what's up, guys? That is exactly how salvia works. I smoked it the first time probably about 4 years ago. A buddy of mine who was overseas came back over and talked about it. He had tons of it. It was legal at the time. They used it in cooking. And you smoke it out of a water bong, take two deep 30-second hits, and the initial high is the highest the first 3 minutes, and you hallucinate like never before. It only lasts about 10 minutes. You start coming down.
And so you're just like everything's turned into fractals, right?
Oh, everything's crazy. When I smoked it, after I took the second breath and let it out, I thought a fucking train was coming through the room, and I dove behind a couch.
Why do you pay for that experience?
Well, I didn't pay for it, but I would have.
See, Reed has to have some type of like logical justification why people do this.
Well, dude, I don't want to feel like a train is coming through. Right? Why do I want to dial that up?
I used to. Hey, there's many country musicians that would disagree with that. And I believe the Gap Band has a bit of an issue with that statement.
What?
Do not diss the Gap Band.
No, you're right. We don't.
You have to understand, when I sat next to Reed when we worked at an ad agency together, he would sit there and lecture me yes, you did, about right. drugs and all this other stuff. It was horrible. So then he leaves, and it's like he'd gone off to college. He comes back, and the next thing you know, he's like, yeah, man, I've been hanging out and smoking and drinking. And it's like,
what are you talking about?
Dude, you turned into a drug addict there for a while.
I'm all right with drugs. I'm all right with alcohol and all that stuff. But why do you want to pay to freak out? That's what I don't understand. These people who do like angel dust or all those weird things that make them feel like, you know, their skin is peeling off or something. Why do you want to do that?
Some of us are running from just ourselves. Eli in Texas, you're on the Lazlow Show. What's up?
Hey, what's up?
Hey, sweet.
He's smoking right now.
It's electric right now.
Right. You're on the show, dude. Let's go.
All right, you can actually buy the Salvia Divinorum seeds on eBay. It's pretty cool. They're actually pretty cheap, too.
Excellent, thank you. Wow.
So it's legal to buy the seeds, it's just not legal to have
I don't know. I've seen places that you can just buy it online. Johnny Fairplay, what's up? Thank you. Dude, this morning I told Rita I went to like dog training, you know, like group dog training or whatever. And there's people with those toy dogs, and I don't know what happened to America, but America used to be about fireworks, alcohol, and having a man's dog. And everybody's carrying around these little fruit fucking sissy dogs. Like, little toy dogs, especially here in Manhattan. Yeah, Reed and I were talking about, like, in Chelsea.
Yeah, it's the worst. When you have a purse for your dog, something has gone...
And you're a man.
And you're a man. Something has gone incredibly wrong. But it's just like everything is designer nowadays, you know, handbags and clothes and...
And they try to, like, you know, they're trying to teach these dogs, like, heel. You know, how do you say to, like, a little Yorkie, you know, heel and stay? Those little things don't pay attention to anything, dude. And yeah. they pee inside. Any dog that pees inside on a little mat... there was a great article in the New York Times recently about all these, like, they're doing all these crazy science experiments on dogs, like mixing them together, and they've got these awful names. Reed, you were looking through some of these, like the Labradoodle,
right? Which isn't that a poodle and a Labrador mixed together?
Why you got to do that?
Like, isn't? But I mean, physically, how does that mating occur? Because that's like I don't know. You know, that's like a huge dog banging a...
It's like sumo wrestler fucking a 9-year-old boy.
Yeah, because when I was growing up, there was a poodle that lived across the street, and it got raped to death by a bigger dog.
It got raped to death.
I swear it did, because it got its insides all torn up.
Wow.
That's not the way to go if you want to go, I'm just saying.
Yeah, I would say getting raped to death is probably not the way to go. But they have names like Pompapoo...
What's the Pompapoo?
Oh, it's a Pomeranian poodle.
Jesus.
A Bogle, which is a beagle and a boxer. And dude, you see so many men carrying them around now. It's a shame.
Yeah.
And they've got these little poops the size of rats. I had a very weird experience 2 weeks ago. I was running a half marathon, which was a really ridiculous.
What has happened to you?
I don't know.
I used to know you, man.
I got mad issues.
Yeah.
Because my chick's like an incredible runner, and me, I'm on the sidelines, you know, out of shape and horrible. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to do this. I thought I was going to die for a good portion of it, but it was in the Bronx half marathon. They have one in every borough. There's a Staten Island one, a Brooklyn one. But you know how...
So you choose the Bronx?
What was the most
scenic of boroughs?
The nearest one. Let me tell you. You know when you go through many areas of America and there will be roadkill... It's often a squirrel, sometimes a turtle.
Yeah.
We were running the streets of the Bronx, and there were smashed rats. But several. Rats getting run over by cars. There's so many rats up in the Bronx.
Yeah.
Dude,
it
didn't do much to help my stride. I got it when I'm, like, having to jump over squashed rats the size of cats.
I know. When I used to live way uptown, you know, they definitely take care of the nicer neighborhoods in New York City better than the poorer neighborhoods. And so when I used to live way up near Harlem on the west side, you know, I would have to walk home late at night in the middle of the street because the rats would be swarming the sidewalks. You know, it's like that. You ever see that Crispin Glover movie with, you know, he controlled a rat army?
No.
Oh, that's right. I forgot.
Right.
You're pop culturally illiterate.
Right. Remember that Wayne and I have not been to
What's the last movie we went to?
We saw The Clumps together in 2001. One, I think.
No, let me guess, weed was involved.
Sure.
Sure, beforehand.
Weed and beer.
And I've been to the theater maybe twice since then.
I feel honored, though, that I have seen one of the last three movies that Lazlow has seen in the theater with him.
Yes. Star Wars Episode One. We went and saw Star Wars together, and we were looking at each other through it. It was so disappointing. It's like when you wait 9 months to sleep with a hot girl, and then you get her into bed and realize that she is a man.
Right.
It was just horrible.
Yeah.
It was really, really horrible.
Is that why you stopped going to movies?
No, I stopped going to movies because I don't enjoy paying $10 to watch 45 minutes of commercials before the movie and then have a bunch of assholes babbling on their cell phones and fucking talking, and the whole experience, it just sucks, dude.
Yeah, what is wrong with it? When did that become okay? When the shit rings and they answer it.
Yeah.
Oh, what's up? Nah, nothing. Just hanging out in the movie. Yeah. Nothing. Nah, yeah, dude, I can talk.
I saw Patrick Stewart. I saw fucking... Picard on Broadway, and he's up there. I mean, an amazing actor. And somebody's cell phone rings, and they answer it. And they're talking, and we're sitting in a Broadway theater. I'm like, dude, what the fuck is wrong with you?
Yeah.
That's why I enjoyed that cell phone jammer that I used to have.
Oh, yeah, you still got that?
Well, yes, I do. Well,
is it illegal? You're not allowed to say?
Maybe not. I don't know.
We should do something with that.
Yes, we should do a quick break. Coming up in a bit, we've got some DJ Jaguar Skills is going to be checking in from London. Reed was complaining before the show that we don't have any listener involvement, and I say nonsense. People are talking about bad drug trips all on the phone line here. But we've got people that have sent in production for the show, because it's not Reed sitting in front of Pro Tools at 1 in the morning putting things together for the show. It would be Lazlow. And so I think that we should put it out there and have people... Do you mind? You eat your fucking Twix.
You said we're going to a break.
Right, but you wait until we've gone to break before you start crackling and crinking shit on the fucking mic.
Look. All right, dude, look. No.
I think we should invite people to send in production for the show. Whether it's we need special production for Wayne, special production for Reed.
Right.
Someone who could get guests.
Well, don't. You can bite my ass, dude, because all you do is eat a bowl
days.
Of soup and come and sit
fucking
here.
Fucking 30 days.
Look, man, I tried 8 comedians. Eight.
Listen, you could have got a friend to come in here, someone we don't even know.
No, see, I don't want that.
And front
I would
the
rather
whole
have,
fucking thing.
Now, I would rather have no guests than some hack-ass comedian, because there are tons and tons of hack comedians.
Correct.
So I have to know them or know of them or know of their material before we invite them on there. You can't just have anyone who's going to get up here and talk about, like, do 10 minutes on airlines or some shit.
Well, this is coming from the guy. Reed said, instead of getting a guest, how about we send Danny or somebody downstairs with a sign that says, "Are you funny?"
No.
And have them come be on the show. And I ran it by Danny, and he just shook his head and said, "Does Reed understand radio at all, that it has to be somewhat fucking entertaining?"
No.
And there was another show that tried this brilliant exercise as well, didn't they, Danny?
Yeah, a few months ago. I don't know if you guys know Dee Dee or Cricket or whatever the hell she goes by, that chick that used to come on O&A's show from the Kids Channel. And when she came up here to do her Saturday show, that's exactly what they did. They went down on the street and brought back some fucking terrible, awful, like, opera singer or some shit. And it was just dreadful. Not like the show was, you know, wasn't dreadful enough. With Herb doing it.
Great.
But wow. They had to bring some fucking stranger from the street to drag it down even beyond those depths.
Right.
So believe me, not such a great idea.
No, I said I want to go get one of those comedians from Times Square. You know, those people who always stop you and are like, "Hey, do you like to laugh?"
Right, but here's the deal.
But those guys, man, you know, you got to feel bad for those guys, because those are comics themselves that, in order to get on stage that night...
Exactly.
Yeah, but I mean...
So you don't think they'd like to a nationwide spotlight?
Well, I'm sure they would.
Yeah,
but
I'm sure they would, but we sort of, you know...
If they suck enough that they got to bark on the fucking street, man.
Correct.
That's exactly it.
Dude, so, we've had... But here's the deal. We want people that are good, not people that suck.
No, dude, if it's so bad, sometimes it's good.
All right.
Hmm.
Well, go to break while we do a little Radio 101. We've got a surprise guest coming in on the show, actually.
Did Reed book him?
No, Danny booked him at the last minute. He promised that he might actually come on the show and hang out with us in a bit. This is the Lazlow Show.
The Lazlow Show.
All right. Episode 31 of the Lazlow Show. The website, lazlow.com. The phone number is 866-WOW1WOW or 866-969-1969. Going through a quick little bit of mail here. After the last show, Reed talking about his favorite bands. We got some email from... You know Reed's in trouble when people are hunting down a fucking internet cafe in their shitty village in Africa to send an email... about how awful Reed's music and taste is. But here's one. I'm from Lithuania, which is...
Why are they listening?
Yeah, exactly. I don't even know Africa or wherever it is. I've been listening. Loved your 30th episode. I'm a big fan of GTA 3. I'd love to go to Jamaica and get shit-faced with Wayne. I can't find any good weed here in Lithuania. And about Explosions in the Sky, Reed's favorite band, what the fuck? That sounds very gay. Emos are listening to that kind of shit. And another thing, how could you eat tofu? Here's yet another one from Lithuania. I'm from Lithuania, and I'm big fan of the Lazlow Show. I followed your show since episode 26, so that makes 5 episodes, which made me laugh really good. What I really want to say is in the episode 30, Reed said he listens to Explosions in the Sky or something like that. So I thought I'll download a few of their songs. I have to say, it's the worst music I've ever heard. Good luck doing your show.
You know, I think the rule should be you can only criticize me if you can fucking spell. But but thanks for that from Lithuania.
They wrote that as an email and it has spell check and it still fucking came out wrong.
And I didn't say that Explosions in the Sky was my favorite band.
Explosions in your face.
Right.
Dude, favorite band.
They're a good band. You may not like
them. Dude, I don't know who this guy is watching our show from out there, but that fucking neck brace has me right back in the courtroom with Mr. Brady. I don't what right. the. I'm going to throw the suitcase and see if he turns his head. good. Now we've got Explosions in the Sky.
Okay.
Here's another email. Says, subject, I loves you. And then a little heart with a made out of emoticons.
Great.
Just kidding. You're an asshole, Lazlow. But Reed and Wayne rock's ass. Reed is smart, unlike you. And Wayne is fun, unlike you. Reed isn't worthless. You are. Keep up the good work, bitch. And can you tell... This is from Japan, by the way. And can you tell Reed I want to sex him for me?
Oh, please, God, yes. Wait, is it a guy or a
well,
girl?
Well, he's desperate, man.
It's a guy, I think.
Why does a guy want to sex me from Japan?
What is it sex with? It sounds like he's turning frogs over and going, ah, oh, it's a male.
He's flipping through that Japanese-English dictionary.
Exactly.
I sex you. Wait, so who signed that? Wait, do they include a picture?
No, they don't include pictures.
Look how interested he is.
I know.
Hey, you didn't get any fan mail with people wanting to sex you, dude.
I don't really want to be sexed by our fans, my friend.
Let's take a quick tally of people that want to sex me through this show, which is like 20 minutes old. Your wife, one, and somebody in Japan.
Right. So far we've got...
That's 2-0.
So we've got
2-0. I walked out of here with those two porn chicks.
All right, that's true. All right, that's true. I give you that.
So,
And Laz walked out with the gay... With the porn star, the male.
Oh, that's right. Joe. As the most awkward interview I've ever done, as a man's junk is hanging out, and I've got a microphone in his face, and Wayne's cackling 10 feet away.
Because his cock is like hitting your belt buckle and shit.
Ah, memories.
That was a fun night, though.
Yes.
We have, I wanted to get him back on the show when we had the porn producer, but Reed's like, oh, no.
No, that would be good.
It's only good if he brings the girls.
Yeah.
No, I think it's good if he brings us to a set.
Dude, this is the porn producer that gave us he gave us some of his videos, and I thought they were going to be normal videos. It's people getting paint enemas and shooting paint on each other's faces out of their butts.
And one where a guy smokes water bong out of a girl's ass.
Mm.
But I would like to see the one of the night we went.
Oh, yeah, what if that's out? We should get that.
Because that one we were there, and it didn't really involve any enemas or, you know, fucking any shit or anything. I did hear of enema being talked around.
We should get that.
Yeah.
You think
there
in it?
There you go. See, you got 30 days.
We're on the extras.
No, come on.
I never knew that porns have DVDs. Like, when you're done jerking, you're like, oh, I'd love to see the commentary track, you know? Yeah, this part when he's banging her in the ass. There's God, I remember that like it was yesterday. You know, we really set that shot up. You could tell the lighting's really nice, and it was hard getting her the meth so that she could actually withstand that much ass pounding.
We also made it into Screw Magazine for that night.
Yeah.
I knew that. I saw that. But wait, what are we doing on the extras?
We're on the extras.
We're just sitting there?
Yeah, it shows us sitting in the director's chairs.
Oh, my God.
Right. And then there's that woman next to me that was diddling herself there in the thing. I had no idea. And Wayne's like, there was a woman flicking her bean the whole time. You didn't even notice. I'm like, how am I supposed to notice? There's a girl 5 feet away from me getting pounded in the ass.
Well, remember, the director offered to let me walk on the set and have a bit part a waiter, even though we weren't in a restaurant. We weren't shooting in the restaurant. What the fuck was that? I was just gonna walk through with like a tray.
I know. Reed was really worried. He didn't want to. He didn't want to do it.
Well, I don't want to. What? I don't want
to
be in
there.
Dude,
just to say that you've been in a porn.
No, but why is that a good thing? Once again, no.
You are
dude.
The fucking killjoy of the universe. Let's get back
you
to
didn't
this.
Do it,
listeners. I would have. Listeners, sent in some production. This guy's name's Nick Qualantone, and I know him through. We set up this website. WKTTradio.com, Rockstar Games set it up for GTA 4, where there's a 1-800 number on there. You call and leave a message, and we listen through the messages, and you could possibly be, we might put that message in Grand Theft Auto 4. We had tens of thousands of people call this line, and I had the excitement of listening through them every weekend, hours and hours of messages. Some of them funny, some of them racist, some of them made it into the game. But this one guy, Nick Qualantone, must have left, no lie, 30 messages with funny little skits that he did on the phone for 2 minutes. And then now he's sending in production for our show. So here we go. Play Moon Patrol.
This is the Lazlow Show. He's a carpenter from Queens. We can't read. He doesn't do much of anything.
I'm waiting for him to launch into Chocolate Rain, man. Yeah. It's,
that was like a horror film. No,
and it's not over, my friend. It's not over.
This is the Lazlow Show. This is the Lazlow Show. This is the Lazlow Show. This is the Lazlow Show.
Lazlow Jones, Big Wayne, and Reed Tucker embark on a noble quest through time.
What the hell just happened?
I don't know. And then he took that little clip of Wayne saying it's the Lazlow Show and just played it over and over.
I kind
of
dug it.
Dude, it sounded like a bad fucking salvia trip. I've never even smoked the shit.
Oh. Whoa.
Yeah.
So what?
Keep up the good work.
Yeah. So if you can send in some production of that caliber, then please. The website's lazlow.com.
The bar is pretty high, though. Yeah,
I love how he's like, I think I'm going to pitch my voice down. They won't notice that it's a different person.
You guys know Wesley Willis, right?
Of course, yeah. Wesley Willis
that
is on really,
that reminds me a lot of Wesley
Willis.
Yeah,
Wesley Willis is on the end of, at the end of every show that we do.
Yeah.
He
right.
does the Rock Over London.
Yeah.
I actually spoke with Wesley Willis, and he did my answer machine message. And then he died.
Yeah, he's dead now, right?
Yeah, he's gone to the great keyboard monotonous. Every song sounds the same place in the sky.
That was a good song.
Yeah, you know what I loved is that I really doubted Rick Rubin's genius when he went from like the Beastie Boys and some of the other amazing Run DMC, all the people that he brought it, and then he goes and signs that guy, and it's like. Yeah, I'm going to do a five record deal with him. It's like, what are you talking about? It's the same goddamn song 12 times. Oh, there we go.
We got some.
McDonald's is a place to rock. It is a restaurant where they buy food to eat. It is a good place to listen to the music. People flock here to get down to the rock music. Rocky Roll McDonald's, Rocky Roll McDonald's, Rocky Roll McDonald's, Rocky Roll McDonald's.
I think he was mentally handicapped.
McDonald's will make you fat.
Yeah, what did he die of?
They serve quarter pounders. They will put pounds.
Stupidity.
Rocky Roll McDonald's.
Okay, I think we got the gist.
We got it.
Thank you.
What I don't understand about Wesley Willis is I can see going to a show and like having a laugh because the guy is a total whack job. But why in the hell would you ever want to buy the album to listen to that at home? It's the same thing with Weird Al. Like, why do you want to hear those same jokes over and over
and
again?
And why is Donny Osmond his friend? That's what I don't get.
Is friends with Wesley Willis or Weird Al?
Weird Al. He's in his most recent video.
Really?
Yeah, I don't get it. Speaking of the mentally handicapped, there was a there was a story like 3 or 4 weeks ago. There was a huge bombing in Iraq, like where 80 people died. It was one of the worst things in Baghdad in, you know, months or minutes or whatever. And there was a little blurb in this New York Times article, and I didn't hear this story was all over the place because it was huge. It was in this pet market or something where these two suicide bombers.
Where they sell the labradoodles.
Yes, right, exactly. Yeah. He's like, I will not let you sell abominations of God. The labradoodles must die. But this article pointed this out, and I saw it nowhere else, that the two suicide bombers were mentally handicapped.
That's right, they had Down syndrome.
And how awesome is that? I mean, that's brilliant, because some retard comes into a public square like, I got a bomb! It's like, sure you do, retard. Sure you do. You know, here's a penny, chew on it for a while, have a good time, or whatever, a Saddam, or whatever the fucking currency is over there.
It's going to be unfortunate, though, when they get to heaven and they won't know what to do with the virgins.
Right, yeah, exactly. Like, you smell pretty. Great.
All that for eternity.
Right. The virgins are waiting on the fucking 9/11 guys, and they get a couple of retards. It's from fucking Fallujah. But I mean, how do you recruit the retards for the suicide bombing? That's so brilliant.
I'm going to say some parents breed that retard to actually carry out that mission.
But dude, you might fight, but he can kill.
You
might put the vest on him. They go, yay, and they fucking blow up before they even get out
right.
the fucking door.
How do you trust him?
Right. You know what I think? What they probably do is they have an arm.
Remote control, yes.
You know what? Now that I think about it, I think it was remote control. Because you can't trust a retard to blow themselves
up. The retard probably goes up to the first cop or military officer and says, I'm lost. And all of a sudden they got like a pack of people around right. him. And boom.
Yeah, because everybody likes to you listen to a retard. So when the retard's running through going, yay, puppies, in this little public square or whatever, people come on, oh, look, the retard's playing with a puppy. Boom! Yeah. Speaking of retards, have you seen The Retarded Policeman?
No.
My buddy Will Wheaton sent me a link to this. He's actually in one of these clips. It's this guy with Down syndrome who is making these videos online. He dresses up as a policeman, and his buddy has a camera or whatever, and he pulls people over who are obviously in on the gag or whatever, but he helps write these things. And it's pretty interesting. Here's one where the retarded policeman pulls over a black man.
He is a cop, and he's learning impaired.
You know why I pulled you over?
Cause I was speeding?
No, cause you're black. We're supposed to pull people over if they're black. I'm supposed to hit you with this now, okay?
What? No way!
Yes way. Please get on the ground so I can beat you.
No!
Come on, I'm just trying to do my job.
Look man, you can't go around beating people with clubs.
Well, maybe you can't, but I'm LAPD. I have a quota. Bye!
He is a cop, and he's learning impaired. He's a retarded policeman.
I love retarded police. There's like six of these videos online.
What is the point of that?
It's a retarded kid who mm-hmm. is legitimately retarded with the retarded Down syndrome face. Trying to become an actor by doing these little clips. And he also does, you know, YouTube... On his YouTube channel, he does this whole expose about how he's going to, you know, be a big Hollywood actor and all this kind of stuff. So, I mean, you got to give him some props. It's, you know, it's not bad.
No.
Who doesn't love a retarded policeman? Then here's another one where he pulls over a white guy.
He is a cop and he's learning impaired. He's a retarded policeman.
That's me. Well, hello, Mr. Mitt Fartface.
Hello, retarded policeman.
Do you like apples?
Yeah, they're okay.
Well, I got some apples. How do you like them apples?
Yeah, I'm just curious, how do they let you become a police officer?
I can run really fast. If you're pregnant and going into labor, I'll give you a police escort.
I'm a man. Men don't get pregnant.
Then you are under arrest.
I'll give you a shiny penny if you let me go.
Okay. Taste it salty.
Uh-huh. Have a nice day, officer.
Okay. I'll arrest you later. Bye.
He is a cop, and he's learning impaired. He's a retarded policeman.
What is it about the retards and the money? Why does the money always go in the mouth?
It does?
Yeah, because he's like, I'll give you a penny. And he goes, yeah, it tastes salty.
I didn't know that was a thing.
I didn't guess that either.
But you'd often hear about retards eating pennies.
See, where I grew up, we called them window lickers. Because they were always in the fucking school buses, like fucking drooling with their heads on the window, licking the fucking window.
The funniest part of that is that Wayne actually went to school. Because you dropped out in like
that's eighth, elementary school. I'm talking.
You dropped out in like the eighth grade.
Tenth.
Right.
Yeah, I enjoyed freshman year.
And you rode the school bus.
In elementary school, the high school you went really? To, and on when, the MTA.
At what point were you smoking on the school bus?
Yeah, I'm going to say like 8th grade, 9th grade.
Good.
We should get you a GED. What do you think about that?
I got one of those.
You do?
Yeah, sure.
Damn it.
Why?
I don't remember why, but I got one.
You have to study?
Sure, you had to study.
And what have you done with? When has anybody come up to you on the street and said, does anybody here have a GED?
What I do for a living doesn't actually make a difference.
Do you have it framed, the diploma?
No.
Do you know where it is?
Sure.
Could you bring it in?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, we're going to do a quick break, and I think we'll try to get DJ Jaguar Skills on the phone from London as soon as we come back. Also, we've got some street preacher audio. We've got a prank that was played on this guy, Kyle Kendrick of the Phillies,
yeah,
which was pretty sweet. And Reed is somehow obsessed with Gary Coleman, so...
Who isn't?
We've got to talk about...
He's so little, and
felt like me that was getting molested that day. When,
In that bike shop. It's a classic episode.
We'll be back. This is The Lazlow Show. Lazlow Show, episode 31. The website where you can listen to the last show that we did, and the rest of this show will be posted there as well in about 24 hours, is lazlow.com. We've also got a box set of the show for sale there, which strangely is selling well.
Excellent.
And it really freaks me out.
Yeah, I sign, you know, we send out a letter with it. You probably send me like 40 sheets, like 40 every
sheets.
Month to sign.
It's insane.
And they're all going overseas.
Most of them are, because our dollar is in the shitter.
That's right.
And it cost them about $3 to get this thing shipped to them with all the shows on it. But it's weird. I mean, like, dude, I got email from Ireland. This guy, remember how I was talking about my fetish for Sinead O'Connor? This guy met Sinead and took pictures of her for me.
All right.
And sent it to me. Isn't that great?
That's cool.
She was at the,
That's not actually the Sinead you want to be with, though.
She does look a little bit like my mom in this. Like, she's got the sort of, like, mom do-rag thing on.
Yeah.
Still, dude, I love me some Sinead O'Connor. Angry women with short hair.
Love them.
She's still bald, Sinead?
Yeah.
Is she?
Sure.
Still going for the bald look.
Yep. I'd love to just...
You like a bald girl?
Dude, any girl that just rip up a Bible and then we could make out. It just... a picture of the Pope.
You like a bald girl, though?
I love a bald girl.
Yeah?
I've gone out with several bald girls.
Is this from Star Trek 1?
Oh, dude, V'ger.
Oh,
I love me some V'ger.
She was cute.
She was cute. That's when the bald fetish started, was with Star Trek 1.
You ever been with a...
For me, they gotta have hair.
Huh?
You ever been with a bald girl?
Yeah, my girlfriend in college was bald.
Why?
And then my... chick now.
She's not bald.
She didn't. Well,
she was pretty close.
Yeah.
Crew, definitely.
Sure.
A crew cut.
Uh-huh.
Sure.
That got awkward for a second, didn't it?
Yeah. I just, you know, I don't like talking about my fetishes. Wayne, on the other hand, who in restaurants was talking about how he had a fetish about his girl in a wheelchair. You remember this? It's like a month ago.
I gotta say, you lost me.
You were talking about how if your girl was in a wheelchair, you'd sort of like it because then you could jerk on
her. Oh, you probably could, yeah. Think about it. Especially, you could just probably bend them over at any time and just fucking hammer away.
Because she's paralyzed.
So let's run down Wayne's fetishes that we know about. Baby arms.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
Baby arms.
Sure.
Wheelchairs.
I don't really remember the wheelchair, but yeah, I guess I'll do a bang a couple wheelchairs.
What else we got, Lazlo? You remember? Baby arms, wheelchairs.
When we say baby arms, we're talking about, you know how some people have a deformity and they would have that little flipper hanging off?
Yeah.
Wayne, why don't you tell people about your little fetish there?
Well, in the neighborhood I grew up in.
Hang on. Whoops, that's the...
Jesus.
Yeah, we're a professional
nice
show.
One.
Yeah, exactly. When you see who's here, you'll see how awkward this is for me, too. Oh, I'm still going.
Yes. So I got a new intro.
Huh?
No, you got the same
dude,
old intro,
you got the same,
man.
Dude, we were recycling shit from show 3.
Come on.
Romantic moments with Big Wayne.
All right, so in the neighborhood I grew up in, I had this one friend who had a younger sister. She was about 5 years younger than us. Who was born with a deformity. She had an arm that was only came down to about an elbow and had a little baby hand on it. So, of course, they got the name of Baby Arm.
Wait, they would call this to her face?
No, not really, no.
Okay.
And she always walked around kind of camouflaging it by like hanging a coat or a sweater over her arm and kind of walking around like she was carrying it, so you didn't really see it. But if you knew her, you've seen it, and I developed this fetish of knowing that if she was to have given me a hand job and jerked me off, that my dick would feel enormous.
It's true. It would look huge.
That's where my fetish for the baby arm came in.
You're a weird man.
I've moved on.
Well, you moved on to wheelchairs is what you moved on to. Is there any other afflictions that you wanna throw out?
I'm into ass eating. Big time.
I don't think he was joking.
Yeah,
I am not.
Is the phone working in there? What's the deal? Can we get Jaguar skills on? We've suddenly gone from wheelchair. What are you doing? They don't know how to make an international call? 1 minute. All right, he's got to type in his fucking code of some sort.
I'm worried about Jaguar. You know, he used to send out emails to me every once in a while, but now it dropped off, man.
He's huge. He's on the BBC radio now.
He does his remixes, which are kind of kick-ass.
Yeah. In fact, he sent me a remix that he did that we'll play a little bit later. But, you know, for people that don't know Jaguar skills, he was he's convinced that he's a ninja because he took martial arts and DJ'd at the same time. There's something that happens to people when they get really into the martial arts, Master Poe, that they sort of lose grip of reality and everything becomes some kind of weird Japanese watercolor manga film for them. You know what I mean? Where they just like, oh man, you don't understand. Like, the Orient is so mystic. Like, is it?
Great. Right. You live in Belgium, asshole, or wherever he is. Where is he now?
I think he's in London.
That's right. Because he was getting kicked out of country after country for a while.
And then he
there.
OD'd. That's the. Oh,
that's
he
right.
was Jay Jagger's personal DJ.
That's right.
And he was in Ibiza, as they say.
That's right.
And,
that's right.
And he was DJing for Jay Jagger and Paris Hilton and and then that one cocaine model.
And Kate Moss. Yeah.
Kate Moss right. wanted to bang him in the DJ booth. And he's like, no, I've got a girlfriend in London. It's like, God, you're an idiot. But evidently we won't be talking to him because the guys can't figure it out. Maybe we should reveal our mystery guest.
I think we should do
because,
yeah.
You know, it's really disappointing calling Reed the producer when all he does is he gave me a list of labradoodles and like weird dogs. And I got word that a certain someone might be coming in. Oh, we got Jaguar Skills. Well, the special guest will have to wait. Jaguar Skills.
Yo.
Yo, dude.
What's up?
Okay, so to explain to people, you're a DJ, but you're also a ninja in training?
Yes. Yeah. No, fully trained ninja.
Okay.
I'm a ninja.
Okay. And how's that working for you employment-wise?
I can't say any more. What more can I say?
And so you got... You had a hideout in Spain and you got kicked out.
Yep. Yeah, that was crazy. Then I moved to Scotland.
Uh-huh. You wanted to go to some place that was dark and dreary and everybody drinks too much and wears dresses.
Yeah, it was fucked, man. Scotland's fucked. For real, man. You don't want to go to Scotland. They deep fry the pizzas out there, man.
I've heard that the depression and alcohol abuse is pretty hardcore, and I've heard that in parts of Scotland you literally can't walk the streets at night because there's just drunk soccer riot guys.
Right. So I came from a mountain up in Spain, right? So I was chilling in a mountain in Spain, and I go to fucking Scotland, right? So it's pissing it down and pitch black. And there's dudes that are walking around with fucking T-shirts on, man, and it's like -4 degrees.
They're proper hooligans.
Honestly, like... Shit, man, you know. Then they drink heavily out there. It's crazy.
And you told us
that...
You told us you were going on the wagon because you OD'd. And you went straight. You went straight.
Yeah, I forgot about that, man. I'm back on it, though.
How do you forget... How do you forget about OD'ing? Oh, I'm back on it.
No, you know, I did. You just reminded me.
Do you realize that it might be indicative of a drug problem if you've forgotten that you overdosed once?
Oh, man, this year was crazy, man. That was at the start of the year. I kind of got my shit together and then went fully head-on into it this summer.
And so you're a DJ on the BBC now?
Yeah. 7 million listeners, man.
That's amazing. And, have you been...
Yeah, so I haven't revealed my problems to them, man.
America. Yeah, you got it, dude. If you're on the BBC, you're gonna have to be a little bit more legit.
I'm trying to. I'm working hard, Lazlow, man. You'd be proud.
And so, have you been spinning for any famous celebrities? I know you like did the Kate Moss and Paris Hilton thing.
Oh shit, man! Like this summer was bananas. They had shit. Who was that? Kylie Minogue. You know Kylie Minogue?
Yeah, evidently she's big in England for some reason.
Pardon? Yeah. She's really good. You know, there was a whole. I DJed with a whole bunch of people this summer, man, and it was amazing. And you know what? The cool thing was. I was better than all of them.
Well, I'm glad that the coke hasn't fucked with your ego any.
No, it hasn't. Seriously, man. It's good, man. Right now, I am the king.
Well, a little bit later, we'll play that remix that you sent over, but it was good to check in with you, man.
Oh, hey, man. You take care, boss.
What's the website?
Oh, myspace.com/jagskills. You can get all my mixes on there and all my remixes, everything.
And it's skills with a Z?
No, with an S.
Oh, well, glad we've been friends for 3 years. I don't know that. All right, dude. Yeah. Go keep it real.
Peace.
Yeah. I love those international conversations that you have.
That pause?
You have to wait for that. How are things? Over. And then there's that awkward fucking comment. Okay, but we should get back to introducing our mystery guest. If he's still out there drinking Guinness, our mystery guest. Now, last time I came pretty correct with a guy from Saturday Night Live.
Whose name you now cannot remember.
I can too.
All right, who?
Fred Armisen.
Yeah, good.
Took you a second.
And and then this time I pulled out of my hat a gentleman who sits in that chair Monday through Friday. Ladies and gentlemen, Jim Norton.
Die. It was murder. Murder.
Love the Quincy impression.
Dude, that
Jesus.
That Gimsy stuff.
Gimsy.
And I barely even remember Quincy.
I know. And he just pulls it out and does a Quincy impression. Who does a Quincy impression?
Exactly. It's like, who wants to hear my Eric Estrada?
It does bring you right back, though, to those stupid old Quinn Martin shows. Where it was the most unrealistic depiction of a medical examiner ever. Right. Because usually the medical examiner pulls up, they load in the body, whatever they do, bring him back, autopsy, whatever happened. He was involved in explosions and he would arrest the guy that killed the person. Right. What the hell is that about? It was murder.
And it's really weird when you watch those old shows, the openings.
Oh, yeah.
The openings were about a minute and a half to 2 minutes long. And it's now, they don't even fuck with any of that. And when the show's over, the credits now scroll in about 2.5 seconds. Like everybody that busted their ass on that show goes, and they put it in a little window.
They squeeze it on the side so they can run a promo for the next show or start the next show. Right, I don't even know what they're doing. They might even start the next show. They squeeze it to where no human can read that. No human being can read that.
And if I was, you know, if I worked that hard to be on a TV show, you know, and be the producer or key grip or best boy or whatever all those faggoty things are, I would be pretty pissed at my name just flying by like that. They even do it on Lost, which it's like, come on, slow it down a little bit.
It's like, hey, you know, we do a pretty good job on this show.
Yeah, exactly.
I always thought there was some kind of a union rule where they had to put their name up for a certain amount of time, but I guess that went out the window.
Yeah, that went out with... equal time.
Or internet money and things like that.
Exactly. Look at this. You're getting headphones set up.
Yeah.
So we're sitting here getting ready for the show, and you know, we've got this sort of like pre-show thing down, and Anthony walks in, and I said, I freaked out. I go, this is like your father catching you trying on his shoes and looking in the mirror and playing with his ties. It's embarrassing. It's really embarrassing.
That's adorable. No, I love
Look
your
show. Look
at
them trying to do their little funny show. Oh, they've got clips.
It's like when you buy something for the kid and they give them the money and go, you pay for it. Go to the register. Isn't that cute?
Exactly. So, and how's the fuck palace?
Oh, it's great. I haven't really brought that up yet.
Leave it to Laz to bomb you.
I was, well, the house, let's just say the house is very big, and when you run solo in it, it makes a big echo.
Yeah.
And there are things that, you know, you kind of take for granted, like the toilet paper doesn't grow on the roll.
Right.
When you're done with it, it doesn't replace itself automatically.
Somebody to yell at.
So I just figure I'm going to have to pay the Mexicans a little more to do a few things that used to just get done, which is like buying stuff. I need, really, Alice from the Brady Bunch. That'd be perfect for me. Just cook, clean up the crap, do the laundry, and then get out.
How long has it been since you've actually cleaned your own bathroom?
Holy Jesus. I don't think I ever did, even when I was like... I was one of those guys where when I had my own apartment, it was... We called it Pee-wee's Playhouse because screw paying the rent. We'd rather buy toys, radio-controlled helicopters, Verti birds, dart guns, whatever the hell. You know, that was more important than the rent. And dishes piled up in the sink to the point where it stunk. It smelled like fermenting baby diapers. And occasionally, I'd unplug the drain, let it drain, spray hot water and soap in there, and go, I think they need to soak.
Yeah, right.
I think they just need to soak a little. And you realize, I'm not washing these. And then you'd eventually just throw them away and get plastic plates.
We did that in college, and
I did this at about 35.
Right.
So you know, college is fine. You can do whatever you want in college. When you're supposed to be an adult,
My favorite is when I would wake up on the living room floor, and I would roll over, and there would be a pizza box that had been there for two or three days, or since, you know, the party started on Friday, and it was now like, you know, Sunday morning or whatever. And I would look, and I would open it up, and there would be a piece of pizza, and I would be genuinely happy. And I would grab it, and I would eat it.
They saved me a slice.
You would just do things that you'd never do now.
Everything was an ashtray. Do you remember that? And you always ran into the risk of, like, drink a fuck, you know, and it's got a fucking cigarette. And in the South, it's worse because fucking rednecks come to your party. They use beer cans to fucking spit in with their Copenhagen. Yep.
And the last thing you want to do is a swig of that.
Of another man's spit.
There isn't cutting it off. If you start, you're drinking the whole thing.
It's very viscous. Very viscous.
You ever done that, Wayne? You ever picked up a dip cup and... No, not a dip cup, but a beer with a fucking cigarette put out is pretty nasty.
Yeah.
You know, you get that first mouthful and you're like, all right, do I kill it or I put it down?
Yeah. You have the same reaction as Spalding did on Caddyshack. Just puke. That is horrific.
But it was like dinner plates were ashtrays.
Everything. I remember, though, as a kid, at the dinner table, my father would do that. Like, my mother cooks and brings the food out, and then my father would eat, lean back, smoke, and just put it out in, like, his pork chop bone. And you're like, even as a kid, you're like, what a scumbag. Why would you... You know, my mother's just, oh, Joey, son of a bitch.
Yeah, when I worked at this pizza place in Oklahoma, people would do that all the time after they had themselves a supreme pizza, you know, after the welfare checks drop at the first of the month. They would would put the cigarettes out in, like, their egg salad from the free salad bar and stuff like that. It's just so fucking nasty. It's like, dude, there's an ashtray right there.
There is. Even though it becomes all garbage at one point, there's just something so inherently disgusting about that. Just putting your cigarette out in food.
My chick and I went to this wedding out in Suffolk County probably about 4 years ago, and it was a legitimate Long Island Guido-type wedding.
Oh, nice.
And we were at this big table full of, you know, the Long Island girls, the Italian girls, and...
Yeah.
And, dude, they were, while eating, smoking. So, like, bite of food, God. And they're in their big trashy dresses, you know, and their shitty, slutty high heels, and they're fucking...
I think that's pretty fucking hot.
Some people do find that hot. The mustache ruins the whole look, though. That is so funny. Hey, what are we going to eat here? Hey, they're bringing out the blow-up saxophones and the sunglasses. Come on. Get out there. We're going to do kick line to Sinatra.
Joey, you better play some fucking air guitar.
Maria, get in the fucking car. Get in the fucking car. I love those guys.
Shit. Weddings are the worst. And if I never go to another one.
Well, you're going to one next month.
No, I'm not.
You?
I actually got out of it. I'm going to be up in Boston.
Did you? Lucky.
Dude, it's like they. How did you getting married cost me money?
Hold on.
A lot.
I'm invited to this fucking wedding only because it's a friend of his. And hey, I know him.
Have fun. You can report back. You're the reconnaissance man.
Either, man.
You're the recon guy. Tell me how it went.
It is.
I hate weddings.
Dude, and it's just like, and now presenting. We get it. They're fucking.
They have not updated that gig for years.
Right.
They could do the same thing. It's like friggin' Meanie's comedy act. It's the same act over and over again.
And they have to bring out, like, you know, and now the bride is going to dance with her father.
Oh,
it's like, oh,
that's
great.
Good. Daddy's little girl. Right. Here it is. By the way, Daddy, those legs will be akimbo in no time. And this scumbag that you really hate is just going to be tapping the shit out of her. Hey, have a good time. And you paid for it.
Oh, you gotta love it.
And the dad's hand is sort of creeping down her back a little bit too low. It's just like
mom's looking on uncomfortably.
That was like it, dude. I know I said it a couple of shows ago, but at Cousin Ed's wedding was so uncomfortable because his mom was trashed and was hitting on a 22-year-old black gentleman.
Jungle fever.
It was so obvious to everybody. And
want that.
And she's doing like the crazy. What is that dance that white people do over the age of 55 at social functions? Where they have both fists up in the air and they just are gyrating like, and you just want to shoot
what
them.
What is that?
It is so bad. It's just like. It must have been before pre-Elvis or something when whiteness was so pure and weird and
white.
And she was doing that crazy dance in front of this poor black guy, and then she fell down.
Nice.
Yes.
Nothing better than the embarrassing falling down at the wedding, because everyone kind of goes, whoa, and it's horrible. But the table that they put in the side with everybody is the only one laughing. I'm always put at that one table where it's like, I don't really know these people, but I kind of know why I'm sitting here.
Right.
They wanted me out of the way.
That's like, the table I'm sitting at this wedding.
Yeah, that's where you're going to be, right?
The back corner.
Don't let them ruin the fucking pictures.
I always seem to be. Oh, my God. We went to my chick's brother's wedding, and we were a bit lit. And you know how those disposable cameras are on all the tables now?
Put them on the table so we don't have to get a photographer.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, sure.
Oh, it'll be great because then, you know, we'll get those, and those disposable cameras take shit pictures anyway. So I was like spelling shit out with my food and taking pictures of it. And then I went into the bathroom taking pictures of the urinal cakes.
Well, there's a certain friend of our program that will take those cameras and pull out the brain, you know, you just pull the scrot out the zipper, kind of zip it up, and it looks like the brain,
right.
And he'll just take brain pictures and leave it on the camera, and I'm sure the bride loves that.
One of your fucking friends, I'm sure.
It's their first argument.
So I want to get to this this spoof about that. We were talking about the election earlier. There was the videos that people are putting together now to help their candidate, you know, like that horrible fucking Hillary thing that you guys have been.
Oh, is that awful and fantastic at the same time?
And to have an ego that you're sitting in your house, you're like, somehow I have to contribute to democracy. I know the Laverne and Shirley song.
Yeah. That's what I'll do. You know, it might have worked once when the little drummer boy decided to give a tune as a gift to Jesus. After that, a gift of a tune stinks. It's not a good gift.
So now what people are doing is they're making like remixes. And so I found this remix. Somebody took an old propaganda video and inserted John McCain audio. This is pro-Obama. Mm. Put in John McCain audio in there as well as Obama stuff. Being a long opening.
I like this music. I like the era.
Sure, everybody knows John, and it's certainly true that he's known far and wide for his talks.
They don't send us to Washington to stroke our egos, to keep this beautiful
bountiful, blessed country.
I just thought, what is with the whistle of John McCain's voice? He was like,
probably the way the VC dislocated his jaw 18 times makes it a little hard to say his S's. Okay. You know, an AK-47 butt into your lower jaw might give you a little impediment.
Bountiful, blessed country, safe, prosperous, and proud.
John bores everybody stiff, has for years. He's usually referred to as old stone face and is asked to speak only because he's willing and available.
It should respect the rights, property, and under opportunities of the people to whom we are accountable.
The trouble is, he isn't interesting. His topic is interesting, but he doesn't put it across. Now here's a young speaker who is really in demand, because he is interesting.
There are days of disappointment, but sometimes, just sometimes, there are nights like this.
As he talks, he paints a picture with words and with gestures. He leads his audience by the imagination until they almost believe they see the scene he describes.
When more families can afford to see a doctor, when our children inherit a planet that's a little cleaner, and safer.
The difference is not in what they say, but in how they say it. He's animated. He looks alive. John is just talking.
Wow. I haven't seen that one on TV yet, but I'm looking forward to it.
Oof. And, okay, so he does have a little bit of a speech impediment, but he calls it Washington.
Washington. Yeah, there's a certain segment of the country that says, you know, I got to do my wash.
It's also the same segment of the country that believes there's an S at the end of Walmart. Yeah, we're going down to Walmart's. my grandmother always used to say, we're going to Walmart's.
Walmart's.
I'm like, plural? Or we're going to several Walmart's? So, and then somebody did, the same guy, his name's Hugh Atkin, he mashed up Hillary. Do you remember that bit, like, 2 weeks ago, it was such a big deal that Hillary cried, you know?
Yeah.
She said, like, how do you do it? You know, sometimes I just have to keep going with it. So, and she does kind of have that psycho babble and crazy-ass look in her eye. So this guy, Hugh Atkin, mashed her up with that insane Scientology video of Tom Cruise, where he's just... Did you saw that?
Yeah.
Oh, dude, madness.
And my question is very personal. How do you do it? How do you keep upbeat and so wonderful?
You know...
I think...
If you see me every day... Every day...
It's not easy. It's not easy.
I don't care if someone thinks it's hard or easy.
It's not easy. And I couldn't do it.
Okay. Am I gonna do it or am I not gonna do it?
If I just didn't, you know, passionately believe it was the right thing to do.
Do it right.
I just don't want to see us fall backwards. You know, this is very personal for me.
It's not just me.
It's not just political.
It's not just Dave Miscavige.
It's not just public.
It's not just the orgs.
I see what's happening.
You see things the way they are.
And some people think elections are a game. They think it's like who's up or who's down.
Every day. When I think about those people out there who are depending on us.
the whole part of that video of Cruz... if he sees a car accident, only he can help thing. It's
just, yeah. What was that about?
And what is it about action heroes that they start to sort of lose grip of their fictional life and then real life? Because, you know, you see that with a lot of them.
Yeah, he's just a guy driving down the street. He's not Mission Impossible guy. He's not.
Right.
He's not Maverick from Top Gun.
Exactly. There's a car on fire and somebody's trapped in, and it's like, can you imagine? Is you're catching on fire from the petrol that has leaked out of your gas tank, and and you look out the window and you can't get the door open, and you see Tom Cruise, and you're like screaming, "I'm on fire! Call 911!" He's like, "No, I've read Dianetics.
I can do this." I'd use my last bit of energy to grab onto his ankle so he burns along with me. He's completely lost all touch with reality. He lives in such a, I guess, sheltered world of this Scientology thing that it amazes me that he can actually come across as almost believable. He's more believable in these action movies than in his interviews. Right. Like, okay, here's a guy. He just got through 50 guys shooting at him with nothing. With, you know, throwing forks at people. That's more believable than anything he really says. Sad.
Yeah, especially when he's, like, saluting the picture of L. Ron Hubbard. It's like, okie dokie.
There you go. Sci-fi writer L. Ron Hubbard.
I love cults. They are just like those, the purple sneaker guys, all those, the Jim Jones guys. I just, it's amazing. Anybody that has the power to, you know, say, listen, people, here's what we're going to do. We're going to live in a bunker. We're going to amass some guns.
Koresh,
I'm going to fuck half of your women. And if a federal agent comes and knocks on the door and asks why we aren't paying taxes, shoot him. That will end really well. Oh, that drove me insane about, you know, all the fucking wacko liberals who were upset about, you know, I can't believe Janet Reno firebombed those people. They knocked on the door for 100 days. Like, please come out, crazy people. Please come out.
At some point, you can't just leave and say, all right, it's yours. You've just annexed part of this state, and it's now David Koresh land. You gotta kind of show some muscle. I mean, but... Yeah, that started a whole ball rolling of people blowing up federal buildings and everything else.
Oh, yeah, they were really upset about
all that. Yeah, upset about
shit.
That whole thing. Burn the place down, screw it, they're all nuts anyway. Exactly. I like Comet Guy because he not only got people to kill themselves, he got men to cut their balls off. Right. Now, killing yourself is one thing. Cutting your balls off. How do you talk another gentleman into that? Right. Les! I'm just thinking, we've had a few beers here. I got like a Swiss Army knife. What do you say, me and you? Let's cut our balls off.
Exactly. Because you don't need them when the great meteor from the sky comes and scoops us up.
Why would you?
Because I was reading that when the meteor people come through, they're like, they're looking through, the first thing they do is pull your pants down. Like, you didn't hear about the ball thing. They've got to be gone. I'm sorry. We can only take the men that have castrated themselves.
You get that old speech you used to get when you were in a band. You know, total lack of dedication, man. Total lack of dedication. You didn't cut your balls off. Sorry, man. I'll try hard.
I'm keeping mine.
Yeah.
I'm keeping my own cult. Guys with balls.
Yeah. Guys that kept their balls.
Well, but you are, you know, you do have genital mutilation.
Mm-hmm.
You were clipped as a child.
Yes.
That's genital mutilation.
Yeah, well, the sensitivity I have, I really like, so it's staying.
It's kind of hard to have a say in the matter, too, when you're an infant.
Yeah, exactly.
All I know is, I used to do air conditioning and heating installation. I had to go to St. John's Hospital out in Smithtown and do some work over there, and I was right by the pediatric ward where they were doing the circumcisions on children. It was like some kind of a medieval torture chamber. They strapped these kids in to these plastic forms that have a little baby, what would you call that?
Like a baby electric chair.
A shape. Yeah, it's like the shape of a baby in this plastic. And they strap them in, their legs, their arms, across the chest. And then their penis is pulled through this thing, they clip it.
It's like a little cigar cutter thing.
Yeah, little cigar cutter, and they are all... screaming bloody murder, and apparently that's what they want.
And you're trying to install an air conditioner.
Yeah, in that hot atmosphere.
I clipped this. Yeah, would you keep it down? I know your dick has just been mutilated, but.
So there's no Novocaine or anything?
Drop a Makita on one of the kids.
He's
fucking nuts.
Novocaine.
Well, I think
Novocaine. I didn't see them use any pain. They just assume a baby doesn't feel anything or anything to remember.
First off, they're not shooting Novocaine into the mouth of the person who's circumcising them and chewing the fucking foreskin off.
Nah, dude, into your, you know.
They don't care. They're crying. It's like,
I thought Novocaine was just for your mouth.
Whatever.
Whatever numbs it, right?
Oh, yeah, right.
He's not going to sit there and go, okay, baby, you might feel a little pressure. You might feel a little pressure.
I always heard that they didn't give babies any kind of pain medication because, like, they won't remember it. You know?
That's right. That's what they say.
Dude, there's got to be some level of trauma There's got to be some level.
If you have a brain, which you do as a child,
right?
There's got to be some friggin' little cell in there that is retaining that pain.
Right. And then later on in life, you wonder why you're stealing money out of mom's purse.
I'm glad I got clipped, though, as a kid. I am kind of glad about it. You know, it keeps things nice. You don't have to look like a fucking... I don't know.
European?
Right.
Calamars. Calamar.
No, it looks like that weird lipstick that dogs have. You know?
Fucking calzone when you come.
My buddy... My buddy's the... he writes the Playboy Advisor, and he said that one of the... There's the two big questions that they get every month are about circumcision is the first one, where people are like, you know... Especially adults who haven't been circumcised. Oh, I'm thinking about going and doing it. I'm like, what are you talking about? But and then back and forth with women writing in goes, I was with a guy that didn't have it clipped, and it was just amazing and all that kind of stuff. And the second question that they always get are people, guys writing in with scenarios going, dude, just tell me if this is cheating, okay? I didn't touch her, but I just blew a load on her face. I didn't really touch her. I'm married. Is that cool?
It works for the president.
And I hope he says, yes, it's cool. You know, there's a whole sect of people out there now that, like you said, want to be circumcised, but they want their foreskin back. And they go around all day with weights. They put these things around their penis where their foreskin would start. I don't know if it's an adhesive type of thing or whatever it is. It holds on very tightly. And they increase the weight every couple of weeks. And they walk around with these weights in their pants, loose pants. And it's supposed to pull the skin back down over the head of their penis so they can then have a foreskin again.
That's so weird.
Yeah, so are the people that are doing it. I saw it was one of those weird HBO real sex things that are all just degenerate motherfuckers. It's like, there's going to be about 20, 55, 60-year-old guys in the forest naked playing bongos and hugging each other. Yeah, that sounds great.
Those real sex things are so awful because you think it's going to be, you know, hot dominatrixes and all this. And all of a sudden, he's right, it's fat guys at some yoga retreat doing circle jerks. It's like, whoa! Hey now!
Or that the things where they have the couples that come together and relearn about themselves, and it's just these old fat people, and they're massaging. Like, the last thing I want to see is some old lady massaging some old man's balls and him going, oh, on HBO. It's like, get the fuck out of here. Fucking going to Showtime.
And what is it about swingers that they're always fat and
fat, old, unattractive motherfuckers? Right. It's not, there's nothing going on there that I want any part of.
I know. I'm finally in tune with my body. It's like, well, your body's out of tune. I gotta tell you.
Your body's way out of tune. And they sit there and they're interviewed during those HBO things and they got their arms around each other. They're like, oh, we've been swinging for years. And you're looking, going, who's fucking these people? Who's doing this?
Oh, we should take a quick break. I could see. Yeah, dude, the last show that we did, they brought in this Ray and Nephew rum from Jamaica that's like 100 million proof. And Danny was drinking. Danny was
slurring. Shit, stop it.
Danny was slurring at the end of the show. He's like,
I've never seen that.
Listen, I do a good job at this fucking... You tell fucking Steve that I do a good... Do I do a fucking good job?
He's trying to bang Lazlow for a raise. Jesus Christ.
You should have seen 20 minutes after the show.
What were you doing?
I was just yelling the street.
This is Lazlow Show, episode 31. The great Anthony Cumia sitting in with
Thank you, sir. It's a pleasure.
I knew if I brought one of those huge 8-packs of Guinness that
I love it.
You would be come sniffing through. So thanks so much for sitting with us. We've got some other stuff to get to after the break, including some rap that was sent in by Reed, a retarded gentleman rapping, and then some rap from Belgium, which I guess our fans internationally are always digging up some weird-ass rap. But the website's lazlow.com if you want to check out previous shows that we've done, and we'll be back right after this. Show.
Lazlow Show, episode 31. The website, lazlow.com. The phone number, 1-866-WOW-1-WOW. We do a show about once every month. That's the sound of Anthony Cumia cracking a fine Guinness. Mm. And, you know, Wayne's had the flu for 2 weeks, and he said, I'm not drinking at all tonight, which normally he's half in the bag, well, fully in the bag by this point. But he said, you know what? If Anthony is going to bless us by hanging out on our show, then I will drink.
I appreciate that.
And I feel we'll be drinking after the show.
Yeah, we are going out for sure.
Yeah, you know, it's kind of weird, because Danny was saying, you know, yeah, you know, Anthony's been hanging out on Saturday nights. I was like, something has changed in his
life. Yeah, yeah.
We were talking about babies, and this article in the New York Times, I couldn't fucking believe it. Evidently, there's a large amount of people with children that feed their children by pre-chewing the food. and it tends to transmit viruses, and they're finding that people are transmitting HIV to babies by pre-chewing their food.
Okay, look, I'm just going to take a wild guess. To get there, you need to take a plane or a boat. There's no way this is happening in this country.
Well, you can take a plane or a boat to the ghetto, that is where it's happening. Researchers have identified another way that babies can be infected with HIV through food pre-chewed by an infected parent. Mm. Pre-chewing food apparently occurs among many groups in this country and elsewhere. Commercially prepared baby foods and blenders are not available, and parents and caretakers may need to soften foods. Now, throughout all the history that I have studied, I never remember anything about the cavemen doing a baby bird to each other. You know what I mean? It's like there was a time before Gerber food where you fed the baby, you know, something besides this commercial Similac stuff.
Yeah, that's when the kids were like breastfed to like six. You could eat now, go out and kill
but
something.
But also, you were never so impoverished that you couldn't soften the food in some other fashion for your child.
Right.
I mean, even in the Old West, you never saw Paw Ingles chewing and spitting it into little half pint's mouth. You know?
You know, and there's always that debate over breastfeeding. I could just see people debate. You know, we're really tired of these women regurgitating into their babies' mouths in public. It's just, it's obscene.
I was on the subway. It always sounds like that. Wow, that is twisted.
Yeah.
And then the AIDS thing is an extra little added, because it's disgusting on its own.
Right.
It stands on its own as a story.
And what's even better is when you're in fucking junior high or elementary, and it's like, hey, Tommy, how you doing? I have AIDS. Oh, and how'd you get that? Oh, mom was spitting up shit into my mouth.
Pre-chewing.
What are you, a robin?
Yeah, she's pre-chewing the food.
Is just too weird.
Yeah, like I said, even though, okay, perhaps they are here in the United States, but I don't think they're anybody that I probably... have over for company.
Speaking of Nazis, another article that I read,
got your email on this.
No, that's a different one.
I like that one.
The new Pope, as we all know, looks a lot like the Emperor from Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
And he dabbled a little bit in marching during a little war in the 40s.
Sure.
He was in Hitler Youth.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he is now rolling back some of the mass prayers that they do. There's been a revision of a contentious Good Friday prayer approved by the Pope Benedict XVI that is setting back Jewish-Catholic relations. The prayer calls for God to enlighten the hearts of the Jews so that they may acknowledge Jesus Christ, the Savior of all men. And so these Jewish groups are livid. Before the Second Vatican Council, there was when they had Good Friday Mass, they would pray for conversion of Jews, referring to their blindness and calling upon God to lift a veil from their hearts. The unofficial translation reads, of the new prayer reads, "Let us pray for the Jews
May the, and they're doing this in Latin, so it's hominis omnis sanctus Judeus hominis sadis shekels. Let us pray for the Jews. May the Lord our God enlighten their hearts so that they may acknowledge Jesus Christ, the Savior of all men. I was like, wow, what a group to start a war with.
Yeah.
And I started thinking, why would the Catholic Church want Jews to switch over to their side? And I first thought, well, because they've got a lot of money, and mm-hmm. the Catholic Church is kind of out a few hundred million dollars for these lawsuits about the kid touchers. And then another part of me thought, maybe since there's so many Jewish lawyers, they just want better representation.
Yeah, all these guys would be getting off the hook.
Right, exactly.
Your Honor,
he was asking for it. I am a sugar nut. Look at that little tushy.
Oh, Jesus Christ, let him off the hook. My Savior. Well, Catholics have always been... you either come over to our side or eventually we're going to kill you.
By the book or the sword, whichever comes first.
They used to have a lot of gusto with those crusade things.
I hear there's some people that aren't into our way of life.
Yeah.
Let's put the sword through them.
Right. I've seen some of those torture chambers that they used to use. I'm sure a lot of people converted when there was this... a pyramid-looking thing, and you're being lowered on it by your asshole.
Wow, this Catholicism sounds good.
Yeah, I love Jesus. Could you get the pyramid out of my ass?
I love when people are always, they try to rationalize Islam. They're always like, hey, those people gave us math. They gave us algebra and calculus. Like, oh, great. The courses I fucking hated. X and Y. Yeah. Solve for X. No.
X number of heads are taken off.
Right?
If you throw B number of heads in a river, how many?
Right. Oh, man. I saw the greatest quote from saying that... that one of the reasons that Islam has such an issue with America and the West is because of fun. They say that Americans with their religion have too much fun, and that literally you are supposed to suffer. In life, you were supposed. I mean, it said life is supposed to be shit. So
that afterwards you can kind of get your just rewards, but this whole part is supposed to be shit.
Right, and here's a great one. You know, they banned Valentine's Day in the Muslim world because I guess, you know, whatever you get.
Unless you give your lover a real heart from an infidel.
I get this from infidel for you. Oh,
thank you.
And the,
it's full of chocolate.
The Kuwaiti parliament has called for Valentine's Day celebrations to be banned. Another Kuwaiti MP said that this committee will undertake a study this week on how to stop Valentine's Day from initiating the moral corruption of youth. In Saudi Arabia, which we know is quite a tolerant...
Oh, wow, are they great.
Yes, and we love to give them all of our money.
Mm-hmm.
The religious police, who go by the name of the Commission for the Promotion of Virtue and Prevention of Vice, have banned red roses.
Just the name alone sounds like such a fun group.
Right,
you want to party after work with those guys at Fridays?
Yeah, especially when it's like, oh, fuck, dude, who is it? Oh, dude, it's the fucking... Commission for Promotion of Virtue and Prevention of Vice. Hide the bong.
Shit, I knew it. Hide the bong. Not even a bong. Just hide the Valentine's Day card. Okay, this is
Miami Vice.
Evidently,
all of a sudden.
Your fine staff has decided to play Miami Vice theme when we're talking about Kuwait.
A Muslim guy is wearing neon clothing and no socks.
Prevention of Vice.
I wish I had my car crash box. Oh, do I wish I had.
In 2004, the Saudi fatwa, I love that. Mm. Oh, they've issued another fatwa.
I love the fatwa.
They forbade Saudis from celebrating Valentine's Day. It's a pagan Christian holiday, and Muslims who believe in God and Judgment Day should not celebrate or acknowledge that it exists. And then the Ayatollah Khomeini, who was a fucking riot, he said... Allah did not create man so that he could have fun. The aim of creation was for mankind to be put to the test through hardship and prayer. An Islamic regime must be serious in every field. There are no jokes in Islam, which is why I guess they got upset at the cartoons.
Yeah, they certainly did.
There is no humor in Islam. There is no fun in Islam. There can be no joy and fun in whatever is serious.
how are we supposed to get along with these people in this century? Like, this is a, that's a type of people that just obviously are no fun. You can't hang with them.
Let's go to a gentleman on line three. You're on the Lazlow Show. Hello.
I just want to say, Anthony, your racism knows no bounds.
Patrice!
I'm sitting here listening to the fucking Lazlow Show, and good old Anthony that can't come out ever. Have you never visited the fucking Black Phillip Show to give it a boost? You just let my nigga show just fucking slap in the wind. You don't just drop by to discuss relations, but good old Lazlow, you come by and discuss with Muslims with this fucking gaming programmer.
You know, Patrice.
What the fuck, Anthony? I'm sitting there going, no, this ain't Anthony, is it? No. But no, Lazlow says Anthony 75 fucking times. He's visiting for a fucking six pack of beer and a goddamn voiceover. You know, Anthony, I want to love you. I don't want to say this hurts.
I understand, Patrice, but I swear to you, I would come in. But when I called when you were on last week, and this is no shit, I was told there wasn't enough room for one more person in here with your fucking posse. Can you maybe leave a few people home so people can walk through to take a piss? How many people you bring in here?
It's people that need help, man. I want to discuss. Me and you have things to discuss.
We really
and
do.
Lazlow said you got it for a fucking beer. I'll buy you some beer. Come visit.
It's not the beer. It's his lily white skin I love.
I fucking can't believe I'm sitting here, Lazlow. and he gets a fucking coup of a guest like Anthony Cumia to come out on a fucking Saturday.
Well, we do get a lot of good feedback on our show, dude. You know, we do. We got the box set. We got t-shirts.
Fuck you, Lazlow.
Listen, Patrice, ripping off Disney font on your fucking website. That's fucking Disney font on your website.
Damn, no, you did, Lazlow.
Lazlow, take me off your take me off of that goddamn game.
It's called Grand Theft Auto.
Take me off of Grand Theft, you motherfucker.
You already cashed a check, though.
Jesus. If he takes you off, who are the cops going to beat mercilessly?
You know, I'm fucking hurt, man. And you're just sitting there, yes, and the Muslims, and just fucking relaxing with Lazlow. We all would like, I think Uninformed with Billy Bo would like a visit from the mascot.
I have to tell you, Patrice, it is very nice because I don't have to do anything, and Knucklehead Wayne and Reed haven't said shit in an hour.
I didn't know who else was on. It was like, it's just, I'm listening. I said, fucking Anthony, I thought you went into a coffin on Friday afternoon and came back out Monday morning, Anthony.
Well, Patrice, there have been a couple of changes, let's say, in my life, and I'm out a lot more now.
What's going on? Changes
Well, let me just put it this way. Perhaps I should have listened to Patrice O'Neill's relationship show.
Motherfucker! You got rid of us!
I didn't get rid of no one!
Fucking piece of shit! You should never be talking to Lazlow about this shit! You should have been a fucking Black Phillip Esclosa! Oh my God, Anthony!
No,
you got rid of her. You fucking got rid of her, and I don't know.
I didn't.
You was like, you know, fuck that. If Patrice wasn't black, I would have told him. maybe Barack Obama will tell him after he becomes president. Jesus Christ. I'm so hurt.
I know.
I'm so fucking hurt.
I just felt you probably couldn't help me in this situation because your take on relationships is a little different than mine. And, you know, it's the way things go.
Oh, my God. Can I hang up? And could you please tell a slight bit of the story so I can hear it on the radio?
Well, I've been kind of, you know, quiet. I haven't even really addressed it much on our show. Just missing things, some things like, you know, I have to buy toilet paper now and it usually just grows on the little stick there. And, you know, it's just a few things I got to get used to
Oh my God.
being a single guy.
Your fucking self. It's fucking Orgy Central now.
someone called my house the Fuck Palace.
All right, it's on starting next week. I'm telling you, dude, that is Swing Central now. Don't fucking go and do no silly shit like get another girl. Holy shit. Look at what a piece of shit I am. I'm not like, oh, poor, what's your name?
What's your name?
I'm not doing this. Oh, whatever. Damn. Now we can move on. Holy shit.
Oh, Patrice.
I can't believe it. Well, anyway, let me stop. I just couldn't. I'm sitting here listening to y'all. I couldn't believe I heard the voice. Lazlow, you got a coup. And I can't believe, Anthony, you would not. Dude,
I am.
Don't talk about it until I'm there.
I'm fucking. I am guaranteeing this right now. The next show you do, I am there. I'm fucking there on your show.
All right.
You don't believe me?
It is quiet.
I don't think I do.
No,
I
will.
You and Lazlow are good friends. I don't know why, but I'm gonna break you and Lazlow up after this.
We're good friends.
What are you talking about?
He's gonna be.
You threw Lazlow out
of our life.
We can all share Anthony.
Lazlow, I'm sorry to interrupt your show. It was just goddamn shocking. Anthony, I need to hear more of this situation.
I'll brief you, Patrice.
Please say something for me, please.
You will be brief.
He's obviously in a rebound moment because he's hanging out with me on a fucking Saturday night at 11 o'clock.
Fucking no. He's just a lonely old man.
You motherfucker.
Do not get another girl until we talk.
We will definitely talk, Patrice.
This is good news. This is really good news.
Patrice feels like he's got a protege.
All right, see y'all later, man.
All right, man, thanks.
Thanks.
That motherfucker rules. How do you not love that guy?
Dude, I had him at Rockstar 2 weeks ago, and he was just walking through, and there's a bunch of people at their desks, and he's talking loudly.
Of course.
And as fuck. Complaining about that fucking stupid New York monster movie that just came out.
Cloverfield. Yeah.
Just doing like he was on stage, stand up, and people are at their desk and they're looking up. And he left, and a couple people. Well, who was that large black man who was interrupting our work day? And this other guy goes, dude, that's Patrice O'Neill. He's a funny motherfucker.
Yeah. Patrice is great, man, and his show is really fucking funny. I listened to it last time because I was home. I wasn't on his show. But his take on relationships is so out there, and it makes sense in some sick, twisted way.
It really does.
You'd like to believe that, like in an Invasion of the Body Snatchers you've been consumed way. Like, no way a real human thinks like that. But then if you're consumed by the bean pod, you go, yes, this is how it is. This is how it should work. Come over to this side. But I don't know how he pulls it off, how he talks to girls like that, how he talks to his girlfriend like that, who I don't know if it is his girlfriend, the way he talks. He's an enigma. And I said enigma. I didn't say, you know. That means a mystery, Patrice. Don't get all mad.
Damn.
Sorry, this is the Chuck D alarm.
Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah, it's like when we were hanging up backstage.
There's a couple good stories with Patrice.
My sister, who is a pure...
Don't tell me.
Lovely girl.
Not even invited back. Not invited back for dinner now, is she? Oh, didn't go that far, thank God. Jesus.
On his lap... Looking horrified while he's stroking her back. She's like, shh, calm down. And he's like, he was, let me just coax this filly into immoral Congress.
Exactly.
And it was just.
He's one of the smoothest motherfuckers you will ever see.
And he's in the process of inviting her back to his house with his old lady for a threesome.
Of course.
That's something's going to hit you.
That's his MO all the time. Is trying to get a girl back. And now, and we were commenting on this last time, we were commenting how smooth he's dressing now. Like, he used to come in just like a piece of shit. He'd be wearing a jersey. And I guess he thought it was all good because it was new. But it was just like a football jersey and hat and shit. He comes in now pimped out. Wearing a fedora.
Oh, wow. Dude.
And a fucking, like, a suede, fucking red suede jacket. And the guy's like a presence. He's a big guy. And I was like, And then Bobby Kelly, of course, is sitting there because I'm trying to just say, damn, Patrice, you know, you look good and shit. And Bobby's like, ah, don't fucking give him that kind of credit, motherfucker. Shut up, Boston ass.
Yeah, he rolled into Rockstar with that big crazy hat that looked like he went back to the 1920s. And
yeah, he's in the cotton club.
Right. And beat the fuck out of somebody and stole their hat. And he's rolling around with it. And I said, that's a pretty interesting hat. And he's like, yeah, I don't know if I can actually pull this off. And I was like, I really don't know either, but it does look good.
He does. He's a presence, man. The guy's a fucking presence. He really is.
It's cool. It's amazing when I get text messages from your ex during the show. Anyway,
Is she listening?
Apparently so.
Oh, shit. Oh, mine's going off. Let's see what this is. This is called Read Your Texts Radio. Oh, okay. No, nothing bad.
We should do a break. Yes, we're a little bit backed up. Oh, Danny looks
so
excited.
Do a break,
yes. Let's do a break and get the beers reloaded. This is Lazlow show. Let's be honest. It's the Anthony show.
No, Lazlow. Pleasure. Always.
It's the Lazlow show, episode 31. The website's lazlow.com if you want to hear other episodes that we've done. And you can also pick up the entire run of shows and hear us on episode 4 over at K-Rock, where Howard Stern was somehow... Do you remember that when Howard's people were accusing us of going into his studio and changing all the times on the clocks on the wall?
Paranoid.
I was like, dude, what are you talking about?
Who took my strawberries and whipped cream, Robin? Who took them? Ooh, they called me old Yellowstone, Robin.
I was like, are we having this conversation? Oh. And then they're like, we found an Opie and Anthony bumper sticker on the wall of one of the production studios. And I was like,
Did you?
I think what really drove him nuts is when I was on your show, I would take bits of it and I would play it on our show. And that drove him fucking insane.
That was his home turf.
That I was playing you guys on his home turf.
And I was sitting in his fucking studio. So, scrum. And perhaps, I'll be vague, perhaps an announcement coming up for Opie and Anthony soon.
Excellent.
That's all I'll say.
We'll be back right after this. XM202.
And when I first did it, I knew it was going to fuck me up, but I had to do it.
I'm getting ready for the function at the junction. And baby,
All right, Lazlow Show, episode 31. Special guest to Anthony Cumia sitting in on our show and not Patrice's show. Because, I mean, let's be honest. Do you really need to hear 3 hours about how I swing a lot and I get a lot of ass and you don't? I mean, it's
how
real.
He knows how to just hypnotize. He uses Jedi mind shit.
He really does.
I don't know what he does.
Right.
You want to fuck me. I want to fuck you. Pay no attention to your boyfriend in the corner.
Right. These are not the... These are not the... I don't know. I fell apart there.
I wish I had my machine.
These are not the sexually transmitted diseases you were
looking for.
So we were talking about this this Dell call that I got from Danny. And you know how Dell's always got those flyers in the Sunday papers or whatever, and people call in asking about the stuff that they see in there. And so I guess this guy is in India somewhere, and he's got like a speech impediment.
Thank you for tuning in. My name is Robert. What can I build for you today?
Yeah, I'm calling about the computer that's on sale. It's $9.99. It's on a flyer that came in the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to order that one.
Okay, let me confirm everything with you. We have a Pentium 4 processor, 520. We HD technology, 2.8 gigahertz. Okay, DVD player in the first bay, and a free CD burner in the second bay.
If you listen really close, he says... And a free CD boner.
I thought he said boner.
Boner, yeah. That's some boner.
Here in the first bay and a free CD boner in the second bay. No floppy drive. You want to add a 3.5 floppy drive?
Will this not do a disk? If I want us to put something on the disk, will it do it?
Yeah, actually, we recommend you the floppy because it's only $30, 30.
Okay, no, I don't want that.
Sounds like 80.
Okay, are you sure? Because
the future, it's going to cost more money.
Yes, in the future, it will cost more money. By the year 3000, that could be $8 billion.
And the thing with technology is these guys know that most people that are buying computers and things like that, they don't know shit yep. about them. And they use fear, especially with the virus software and things like that. They're like, you're going to need the Platinum Virus Package for $89.99, and then every year you got to pay another $39.99 for the fucking definitions. Well, what if I don't want that? Oh, the hackers will be in soon.
Oh, you're crazy if you don't want that, because like in this day and age.
Right. Have you heard about people getting their identity stolen? That's how it starts.
Identity was first. Now they suck your children right through the computer. My children need to be safe. I
don't want that. Okay, are you sure? Because the future is going to cost more money. Okay, and no speakers.
Speakers don't come with it?
No, sir. It's not in the flyer.
Okay, well, let me read it a little bit better, and I'll call back.
Why? You got the flyer in front of you?
Yes.
And why you call me? That gets back for me. You call me and call me again. That's going to be back.
I didn't realize that it didn't have speakers, and I don't want to have to order speakers.
You know, I was just thinking about, we were talking about this in the break. He sounds like the sausage guy. I don't know how I'm supposed to feed my family and let them surf the internet on a 12-ounce pack of sausage.
With no speakers. My wife needs speakers. She's hard of hearing. The fat clogs her ears from the sausage.
I didn't realize that it didn't have speakers, and I don't want to have to order speakers for this price. So I'll just look somewhere else and find me another computer.
Oy. Unbelievable. Like a little girl. Unbelievable.
No.
Only for speakers. Go ahead, little girl. Little pussy girl. Get out of here.
Danny, is this?
Oh, he did.
Come on. Is this real?
That's hysterical.
Well, first of all, he sounds the guy on the customer service rep sounds like Jesus from The Big Lebowski.
Aww.
Oh, I swear. I found it. I hope. I don't know if it's real. I'm not going to say that it is real, but I pray to Christ that it's real.
I am believing it's real. It's too good.
And he keeps fucking up the English. Instead of saying unbelievable, goes, oh, Ken believable.
Believable.
Like a little girl.
Oh, like a little girl. I can believable. Only for speakers. Go ahead, little girl. Little pussy girl. Get out of here. Get
hey,
out of here.
Let me talk. Let me
get
talk
out of here. Get out of here.
Let me
here.
Talk
get
to your manager.
Little girl. You a little girl. Little girl. Little girl. Little girl. Little girl.
Are you going to let me talk to your manager?
Little baby girl. Little hooker.
Oh, this guy's fantastic. What a dick.
He's been working on his routine in Mumbai.
Yeah.
He's in the Mumbai fucking giggles laugh shack with the like shitty shitty brick wall behind him.
Nobody fucks with the Jesus.
John from Tampa, you're on the Lazlow Show.
Hey, first of all, Anthony, what a sellout. You're like Howard going back to the divorce days.
What that happened?
Sucks. That sucks, but I just want to say it sounds like Spaceship Endeavor.
Oh, the Spaceship Endeavor. Pussy boy.
God, that guy. The reason I want to believe it's real, too, is that he's obviously from India, where a lot of customer service is, and he said his name was Robert, which I love when they do that. Hello, my name is Robert. How can I help you? No, it's not.
I like the strong arm. You know, it's like he doesn't even have to be face-to-face.
Oh, yeah. No.
You buy this fucking computer now.
I am two oceans away from you. Try to punch me, pussy boy. He all of a sudden became like that kid internet guy that can fuck with you because you
yes.
don't know who he is.
Right.
That little son of a bitch.
Meow, 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 meow. It's like he used to watch Mr. Rogers. He's already going, meow, 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 speakers, meow.
Oh, what a dick.
There's another fine Guinness over there for you, Anthony.
Nice. That one's a dead soldier. Anyway,
should we play this this retarded guy that you brought in, Reed? By the way, Reed Tucker's also on the show.
Sure.
Hasn't talked.
Earl Douglas?
No.
Is that, oh, sorry. I hear retarded guy. I just think Earl.
His name is Ray Dog, and I guess he
was harassing some chick online, and she told him to fuck off, and so he made a rap song.
That bitch told Ray Dog to fuck off. What a set.
You don't tell Ray Dog.
No.
I had another song of his a few shows ago that I was going to play, and he kept singing, why must I cry? Well, because you're missing a chromosome, would probably be the reason that you're crying.
Why must I cry just like your parents did?
RVHPOGG. Be careful from them bitches from the internet. I fucked around, these bitches tested my intellect. Time we start our relationship, it was the wreck. We moved too fast, you found me, yes, I should've known. You look like a bitch who's got fucking Down syndrome. Cops in bed to bed, man to man. Sooner or later, she will end up dead. And I said this before, I will see it again, bitch. Take it easy, dog. Take it easy, dog. Take it easy, dog. Take it easy. You're a bitch and I don't want you no more. Tammy Star, you're a whore.
Oh, yeah.
Her name is Tammy Star.
I'd be down with that syndrome.
Maybe you can start making some rap songs about your exes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
When are you done paying mad shekels?
Oh, that doesn't stop until next year. But it's good. That stops next year, yeah.
Good for you.
Yeah, I know. Oh, believe me. And it never ends. Dominic Barbara, who is the attorney for my ex-wife, I saw him at the Borgata last weekend. Because Artie Lang was there and Howard was there. And
is it? I saw a thread on Whack Bag mm-hmm. where they said that you shook Howard's hand. Is that true?
Yeah, we were playing poker. And
you and Howard Stern.
Well, he was at the table next to me.
Okay.
And they roped the table off. So I'm sitting there and going, what, you know, what's going on here? And there's security walks in, takes 4 points around the table, and then Howard walks in and sits down with some of his cronies.
And meanwhile, you've got like what, Club Soda Kenny?
No, I had nobody. I'm playing poker. I don't give a fuck who's around, you know? And I'm playing like 10-20 poker. You know, the pots get up in the thousands. Howard and his cronies are playing dollar poker. This motherfucker makes $500 million, and he's playing with white chips, dollar poker. And somebody on his table kind of looked over and saw it was me, whispered to another guy. The other guy got up, went to Howard. Howard looked over. I just kind of gave him one of those fingers moving toodaloo waves. I was like, hello. So he kind of waved and he said, he goes, oh, you're at the high roller table over there, huh? I go, yeah, I'm giving away some XM money. And he goes, oh, you know, I'm trying to keep it inexpensive over here. And yeah, that was the length of our conversation. But then he got up to leave and he had a stack of, I guess, 20 white chips in his hands, which is $20. I'm like, and then he's asking the guy he's walking with, where do I go to cash these? Dude, no shit. And I'm just like, give it to the fucking dealer. How do you not give that to the dealer, man?
Dude, if I made $100 million a year, yeah. I would have thrown those chips on the floor.
Black chips, hundreds. You could just throw them around like Johnny Appleseed right. and not even notice. But he's asking where to cash in his white chips. And he came by, and we made eye contact, and he kind of stopped, and we shook hands. It was just kind of like, hey, you know, take it easy, good luck, and yeah. we're probably working for the same company soon. And it was, you know, that was it. And then he walked out, but people are, and it's illegal, you know, or against policy to take pictures in casinos. You're not allowed to take pictures. But people with the camera phones just went bullshit taking pictures. So I don't know where those are going to show up.
I couldn't see any of them on the wild thread on on Wax.
But then I'm getting crap like, dude, what are you guys shaking his hand for? It's like, what was I supposed to do? Punch him?
Yeah,
he's supposed to go, yeah, man.
Was his chick with him?
No,
because that's when you bust the move on her.
Him
you
and
right bastard, you bust the move on that horse.
No,
face.
It was that. And I yelled over at Dominic Barbara. I said, "Hey, don't lose all my money." Yes, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, he's like, very funny. You know, you've always been a gentleman. He actually said that to me. Like, gentlemen, of course you consider me a gentleman. I pay my bills.
Right.
Son of a bitch. It was quite a weekend.
Jesus Christ. Oh,
and believe me, that was also the whole weekend of so it was quite a weekend. I won a lot of money, and I lost some other stuff. So
we were talking about the Spirit of Truth, this black preacher. He was on cable in L.A. I watched this guy's video about every 3 or 4 months. I have to turn it on. And it's like he was on cable access in L.A. years ago, and it's a guy zooming in and out of his face with like a scene, a John Denver mountain scene in the background, and he's preaching from the Bible, but he's half mental, so he's cursing.
And make a man offended toward and lay a snare. You know, they try to trip a nigga up like me, you know, because I ain't following Whitey's rules, you know. Be to me. Are you laughing, biatch? You find it funny? You find it funny? Huh? Wait, you ain't called, you ain't hear me, huh? Get it again, okay, I'ma say it again. I come in the name of Jesus. Repeat it after me, bitch. I come in the name of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. God Almighty, you know, ruler of heaven and earth and every goddamn thing in between. You understand me now?
No.
And what I love is you see people on the subway. They go into cars, and a lot of times it will be a black gentleman, homeless, out of his fucking mind, but he'll have a Bible screaming at the top of his lungs to everybody. And it's just like, dude, I'm trying to read a fucking comic book on the way to work, man. Just calm. What is it about the absolute mental and slash half homeless that they get wacky into street preaching?
Yeah. I guess it gives them a bit of power, you know? Because they're out there, they have a voice, even though it's a loony voice,
right.
And it's only while you're passing by and you're saying he's a crazy person.
Right.
But
and here's the deal: if you have figured out the meaning of the universe, maybe get a house. You know, it's like if you have figured out the meaning of why this blue ball is spinning around a plasma ball of hot gases on fire and all these weird things that are going on simultaneously in the universe and particle physics and how it is all created by this omnipotent person, and you've figured it out, you know everything, but you can't figure the house part out.
Hold down a job and pay some rent.
You don't understand. Once you understand the universe, evidently it's your job to get in everybody else's fucking face about
yeah.
it.
And annoy them while they're trying to work so they could pay their rent and have a home.
And this guy had on his show, he would take callers, but for some reason they didn't pipe it through to the feed, so it's like a speaker box off on the corner.
You the devil. You the devil. You a Satanist, huh? You, then you wrote a book too then, right? You got a book with blood on it, huh? You Satan, huh? Who created your ass, Satan? Who created your ass? I come in the name of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. I come in the name of Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. The devil is a motherfucking liar. So you know I ain't worried. Hey. Bitch. Stupid bitch.
Dude, I would go to that church.
Yeah. Oh, hell yeah.
I would go to that church.
You the devil.
Right. You know they try to trip a nigger up.
They call me. I don't give a fuck what you think, bitch. Your thoughts ain't my thoughts. Bitch, I'm flowing straight from the survival scroll. Cut that bitch off. Next caller.
I'm flowing straight from the survivor scroll.
Scroll.
Cut that bitch off.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you do a Google search or actually just go to YouTube and put in Spirit of Truth, some of the videos are 7 minutes long. Somebody taped it years ago and then put it up on, and he's actually been on a few radio shows since these videos popped up.
Oh, he's classic.
I think he was actually.
Here's a letter from the motherfucking Corinthians.
I'm going to tell you some Ezekiel shit right here.
Do we have to do another break there? We have one more break. Well, why don't we do that so we can go into the home stretch and I can get another beer. This is
nice.
Lazlow Show episode 31 with Wayne, who is suddenly gone mute.
Well, it's hard to keep up.
Yeah.
I gotta fucking say that. I don't like you bringing in these ringers.
I can't have had it. It's a great time. I love hanging out with Laz.
And we have Reed Tucker, the useless producer. The website's lazlow.com if you want to check out the show that we did last month. And there's also some fine merchandise. And every box set that you buy, $5 goes to Wayne, $5 goes to Reed. So
and it brings an ounce of weed in about a month.
Oh, nice. We'll be back after this.
XM202. Lazlow Show.
Yeah. You put the fucking beer in the freezer, dude. All the beer's frozen.
Is it fucking concern. Cold? Is it cold?
Yeah, it's undrinkable. Dude, it's really I opened it up and it's like Anthony
I
called it.
I didn't it was drinkable. I actually was fucking cold.
It's like a science experiment.
Yeah, it did. It looked like one of those old science fair volcano things.
I've made Opie's chair sticky.
Ooh. It was like that firework snake. Did you ever get that?
Oh, yeah,
that
those things.
And
those
it just sock. Keeps fucking going and
those
going
those
and going.
Sock. And the poppers. Mm-hmm. Do you remember the poppers mm-hmm. that were like, oh, look, I've thrown this little sperm bag on the ground and it exploded. Yeah.
It looked like a sperm cell.
You know, when you were a kid, it's like, these are nitroglycerin. Because you always saw those, like, Bugs Bunny cartoons and Wile E. Coyote that somehow they were able to order nitroglycerin over the internet.
Of course.
Can I get some paper towels in here? Like, I've got a serious...
problem.
Dude, look at this.
I know. I like how toward the end of the show, the beer becomes the most important part of it. It's like, hey, wait a minute. What, did you put them in the freezer? Did I get one?
God damn it.
Yeah, it's frozen.
Somebody carry the fucking show, dude.
And they're like, yeah, what did you say? Hey, it's at least it's cold. Fucking glacier's cold, dude. Try to put it in a bottle and enjoy
Listen,
yourself.
Did you notice that the Guinnesses were just perfect?
Thank you.
That's what I fucking drink.
By the way, thank you.
He put my beer in the freezer.
Listen,
Guinnesses, by the way, that's nice.
What?
Had to point that out. Isn't it just, did you Guinness. Notice the Guinness was called? Guinness-isses!
You'll learn very quickly that Wayne makes up his own...
I got my own language.
Oh, yeah?
Vernacular.
His own language. That's cool.
Yeah. Sometimes when we're hanging out at the beach, I have to translate for people what he's saying. Because it's like he's taken words and done what they've done with dogs. He's made labradoodles. And he looks like some kind of genetic fluke just came out of his mouth. But I think, and when you call him on, he's like, you know what I fucking meant? I'm like, you just made up a word.
You son of a bitch, you're running a word mill. You love when you know you're doing it. Someone looks at you, you're like, what? Did I say something stupid? I didn't say nothing stupid.
Jesus. Well, you know. At least there's always Rich Voss. So you always got that to fall back on. No one could possibly be that stupid.
I was on Ant's show like a year ago, and Voss was on as well. And after the show, he pulled me over, and he goes, Lazlow, I got to talk to you. And I'm like, hey, man, how's it going? He's like, dude, what is the deal with your show on the virus of Saturday night? It's like, people fucking love it on the message boards. They're going crazy about it. What do you guys do? And I'm like, I really don't know.
Speak English?
I'm like, it's me and my buddy Wayne and Reed, and both of them have no radio experience whatsoever, mm-hmm. and we just sort of sit around and ask, you know, about when you used to steal honeycomb out of fucking train cars in Queens.
Jesus!
Wayne stole an entire case of... Was it honeycomb?
Yeah, cases of... No, it was actually Applejacks.
Oh,
okay. Applejacks are good.
That was back when I guess there was just train cars full of cereal exactly. in Queens for some unexplained reason.
Was there a hobo with a bandana on a stick in the train car too? Like, when did this happen? Who does that?
You have to understand, it was many moons ago.
Yes.
Wayne's been around.
I come from a neighborhood of a lot of criminal activity.
Yeah. And what were you doing with Applejack? Was that the most valuable thing on the train?
That, on that particular day when we broke into the freight, yes, that was it.
My God, they've taken the Applejacks. We got to get Pinkerton on this.
This beer is undrinkable.
No, it's completely frozen.
Mm.
You know, beer fools you when it gets cold because when you uncap it and it... depressurizes, then it freezes on you. Yeah. You think you're fine and dandy. Till you uncap it.
Or till you get a fucking ice headache.
You're not supposed to get brain freeze from beer. You have a beer Slurpee. Right. Thank you. You gave the man a beer Slurpee.
Reed, I wanted you to solve something for me in this whole election. What the fuck is a superdelegate?
Are you asking seriously?
I keep hearing about superdelegates, and somehow they have more power than regular delegates, and it's all up to them about...
Right. They have X-ray vision. No, it's the, you know, it's the governors and the Congress people who can vote whatever, which way they want.
But what makes their vote more powerful than just the regular delegate?
Because the regular delegates are beholden to whatever happened in the caucus in their state. They're supposed to vote that way. But the superdelegates, like if, you know, you're the superdelegate from New Hampshire, you can vote whichever way you want.
So you can be a delegate and decide you really personally you'd like to vote for one candidate, but because of your constituency or whatever, you have to vote for... the other one.
Yep.
And superdelegate can go, fuck it. I'm putting fucking Laurel and Hardy in here.
Writing in Ross Perot.
Yeah,
Paul, baby.
Ron
Paul.
Why have they made it so confusing? And there's so many layers where we really don't make the choice.
Have you noticed lately, too? Have they been bamboozling us for years like this? And then every year, more and more comes out where it's like, we have no control right. over this as citizens of this country. Years ago, you thought your vote made a difference. And then every election, it comes out more aware. It's like, no, it's all the Illuminati.
Yeah. Well, you find out that your votes, and then there's this secret room of the Electoral College.
Yes.
And they sit around smoking their cigars like, who shall we elect? Right. And it's like, why the fuck? I took off work to go vote.
And they called it that because it kind of sounds cool. Like it's just right. a bunch of guys hanging out with milk crates as shelves, drinking beers at a mixer. It's the Electoral College, dude. Right. Scream! Yeah. We're voting, having fun, man, so you don't question it.
Well, supposedly they set it up for just this kind of situation, and that is in case a black person tries to get some kind of yes. big ideas, we'll smack them down.
Yes, he may get the popular vote, but let me tell you about the Electoral College.
We've got ourselves a fire hose, don't we, Obama?
He's running for president and from German Shepherds.
Yeah, that whole they thought that they said that they might get rid of the Electoral College after the fucking mess in 2000, even 2004 yeah. there was contested ballots and all that other shit. And but you do realize with the they're trying to sway the superdelegates. Can you imagine
super-delegates.
This? I'm the superdelegate from Kentucky, and I've got this big S in it. Do I want a thick ankled bitch or a schwoogie?
Yeah, I know, and 99.9% of the people in this country have no clue what the difference is between a delegate and a superdelegate, or what any of the candidates really stand for, because they never do that. We talk about it on our show, how Obama is this cult of personality. He is, people are voting for him. They're loving him. They want to vote for him, but they don't know what he stands for.
Mm.
He's got these great ideas. I want health care for everyone. I'm going to bring the troops back. I'm doing that. How?
Right.
How? No one tells you how.
But he talks pretty.
That's what it is. My
pretty.
God, if you are a little bit, if you have a great tan and you're well-spoken,
he has a great tan.
You're the fucking president. That's it.
We actually have some Obama speaking stuff oh. here. Yeah, yeah.
Next caller, me.
You are a real.
I don't give a fuck what you think, bitch.
Wow.
Your thoughts. Your thoughts ain't my thoughts. Bitch, I'm flowing straight from the survival scroll. Cut that bitch off. Next caller.
You know, how did you get a Hillary's concession speech before she gave it? That's they make the call.
You know, it would be great if Obama, this whole time, he's been speaking so eloquently and just with people are like, wow. And as soon as he got elected and he went up to that mic, he'd be like, yeah, bitches!
We won the country, motherfuckers! It's our shit now! Oh, my God. White people be like, I voted for... Oh, no, he sounded so...
First the Mexicans and now the black people.
The race war is on.
I love
Hyde.
The Minutemen, those guys down in
with the fences. Oh, yeah.
And there was, did you see the video online this week about this Mexican guy with a video camera went and was harassing the I guess they were at a protest.
Oh no.
Yeah, they were the Minutemen and they were protesting right. You know, illegal immigration, and so this Mexican dude showed up with a video camera to confront them.
Oh, they must have loved him.
What an asshole. Just a stinking son of a bitch and asshole.
You know, this isn't racist. Funny. This really isn't funny. It's our country and our sovereignty. This has nothing to do with you now. It has something to do with losing our country. And we don't want to do that. And you people are destroying it.
Hey, where you from, man?
Hey, you guys, ignore him.
Where the fuck you from, dude?
Ignore him.
So this is, that's the guy that's shooting this film is asking, where are you from, dude?
Yeah.
He's gonna throw some Europe shit on him.
I'm from Jalisco, Mexico. That's what I'm from.
You go back to Mexico, you fucking coward.
He's the group.
I'm the coward. You're the fucking coward.
How am I a coward? I'm here by myself. I'm surrounded by Minutemen and I'm the coward.
What would happen if we went into your group?
You're the fucking coward. You come here to mooch off of this country. Why don't you go fix your own country? You got no balls, huh? You got no fucking balls.
Why did your ancestors come here from Europe?
Where the fuck you
in? Because they were cowards.
Okay. Look,
and what am I then? I'm indigenous to the continent.
Which is a good point. They are indigenous to the continent. But guess what? We've built fences since then. It's not it's not the prairie days where it's ooh, winter come, move them, womp them in teepees. Yeah.
It's not these vague borders anymore that kind of move with seasons.
Right.
It's a line. You're not supposed to cross it. I like how Carlos Mencia is doing some new material for his show. This is great.
Cowards, what am I then? I'm indigenous to the continent. I'm indigenous to the continent.
Tell the cockroaches.
Security, you fucking idiot. Hey, quit pushing me, man. Quit pushing me, motherfucker. You just pushed me, man.
I push you.
Fuck you. I saw you push me. I felt
it. Hey,
get the fuck out. I don't have any Mexican fries.
You should be
go to Mexico, you damn cockroach.
Go back to Europe. Go back to Europe, you racist.
I was born here, you prick.
I love it.
I was born here, you prick.
You prick. Go back to Europe, you racist. Well.
And it's what really sucks about the election is nobody is going to deal with this issue because they want that fucking Hispanic swing vote. And ain't shit going to get done about this, dude.
The more the white people in this country become the minority, the more people are going to make these concessions that I think eventually, and it sounds harsh and shit, but, you know, fuck it. It will, I think, turn the United States into a third world country.
We have to. The Martin Luther King alarm has to go off.
Yeah, that's for Wayne, I understand.
You know? Normally it's for Wayne, but we've got a.
Yeah, I've been known to blurt out a few.
Man. Why are these people so pissed off, though? Does that woman want to mow her own lawn? Or I don't understand, why her... What is her deal? Why are they so... Why do we want all the Mexicans out of here?
That's all the... You know something? That's a big thing. They say that the Mexicans that come over here, they're doing the jobs that people don't want to do that live in this country and blah, 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 blah. I live in a lovely neighborhood full of Jewish people. I live amongst the Jews. I love the Jews. You know what? When it snowed the other day, it wasn't Mexicans that knocked on my door to ask if I wanted my driveway shoveled. It was little white children.
With little beanies on their head?
Yes, they had little furry yarmulkes. It was a little cold out. But they sang a little I Hate Jesus song as they just shoveled my driveway. I loved it. I loved it. I think there are people that will do the jobs, though, even if you keep... you know, the illegals out. And they're called illegal aliens.
I know.
I know people have said this time and time again, and I know it's kind of a hack thing to say, but it's not undocumented immigrant. It's illegal. You're not allowed here. There are rules to coming into this country.
My buddy and writing partner at Rockstar and I were talking about this, and he talked about, you know, the traveling around Europe and going into certain countries by train, and... There are countries in Europe and pre-EU or whatever, he and a buddy tried to sort of like sneak into another country, more in the Eastern Bloc, on the train. And men with machine guns put guns to their head when they did not have the proper papers.
The papers.
And escorted them back over the border and said, bye-bye. And we don't, you know. It's
We don't do that. They'd be sued, which is ridiculous.
Or it's like if a cop wants to ask, you know, are you are you an American? Do you have papers? And it's like the fucking activists come out like, how dare you? Yeah, I was kind of finding out if he's breaking the law.
Yeah.
Which is what I do for a living.
That's what gets me when they talk about the federal identification, where every American will need a federal, their papers that identifies you as a citizen of the United States. Oh, it's so bad. It's against our rights and this and that. It's like, wait, they know everything about you.
Right.
Your social security number's out there. You're online giving out all information.
Right.
You got a license.
These are the same people that, like, have those faggoty fucking cards from their grocery store on their key ring.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Oh, make sure to scan it because I'm going to get a free turkey. they're taking all of that fucking data and selling it to advertisers. Yes. And meanwhile, they're like, oh, you're not going to track me.
Do you have a Rite Aid card? Zip. All of a sudden, all your info is being just... it's going everywhere. That's why. Well, why do you think when you go there and buy you buy some condoms and swipe your little card, and then you go to check your email at home and it's nothing but fucking you need condoms, dick pills, everything. It's like, where do you think they find this shit out? When you buy a car, the second you go home, all of a sudden there's 20 car emails. It's like, how the fuck did you get to me so fast?
Well, and I'm notoriously paranoid about those grocery store cards and everything, and I don't like to be
very
tracked.
Mysterious.
You should be. And so my buddy food, fucking Wayne.
In a time I don't fill one out and put down his fucking name.
Didn't know I bought fucking Wonder Bread. This upsets me.
Wayne signs up for anything that requires a name and address. He puts my fucking name and
address. Oh, shit.
Fucking
magazine subscriptions.
Oh, you prick.
You like when you go to a restaurant prick. And they say for your birthday, you come back with the card?
Dude, I get cards every fucking week. It was like, we hear it's your birthday. I'm like, my birthday's not in June. It's actually in September.
Oh, that's awful.
It's like a free ice cream cone at Baskin Robbins.
It drives me crazy.
A bunch of Lazlows out there ruining your credit rating.
Yeah.
Oh, that's horrid.
Thanks a lot, buddy. I really appreciate it.
We're so free to give out our info when it's convenient. And even these people that are against any kind of... federal identification cards, cameras out on the street. You're, especially in New York, you're on camera 99% of the time. You're outside, you're on camera. When stuff happens these days, it amazes me. The news will say, and there was a robbery, and here's the guy, and here's the robbery, and here's 20 angles on it. But the people don't realize when they argue about that every day they are giving out so much of their personal information doing their daily business. You can't go about business in this day and age without giving away huge amounts of who you are, your ID, your social security number, everything. And we just do that without even thinking about it.
And I love that there's companies that make money selling the data.
Selling the info.
About what fucking, you know, Anthony's bite. Yep. Dude, my fucking bank called me and they're like, looks like you got a nice little sum sitting in your... in your checking account. You haven't done it. I'm like, motherfucker, leave my shit alone.
Don't look at my money, my account.
My fucking Grand Theft Auto money, motherfucker, leave me alone.
Mr. Drysdale never called up Jed Clampett, motherfucker, and gave him that shit line. I kissed his ass.
Now, I do have to know, once you guys signed your first big multi-million-dollar contract for NEW, did you get one of those Mr. Drysdale things that you can look through and it's just gold bars? Wow.
I got me a cement pond.
I loved Ellie Mae, dude. Oh, I loved me some Ellie Mae. And then suddenly the Clampets went from black and white to color. I guess they could actually afford.
It was one of those shows that were at that pivotal moment between black and white and color, like Gilligan's Island did the same thing.
Right.
All of a sudden it's like, oh man, that must have been a bitch for the wardrobe department. They're all just wearing gray.
Well, that's why they're having a big problem with HD.
Especially with
newscasts and stuff. You can see you can read stuff that you didn't used to be able to read.
Yeah. And the what makeup used to cover up on the anchors, you know, they're really getting pissed because now they're seeing every little defect on these people's faces. And they're really getting pissed at it.
The Lazlow and Anthony show, Saturdays.
Love it.
Yeah.
Love it.
And what's great is, you know, how you said, Laz, I really want to do your show. Patrice has been asking me, please don't fucking tell him, you know, that we had this conversation. And
you think I'm going on that that guy's show? I didn't. Wait, what did I? What? I was gonna say that nice guy.
Okay, so the Lazlow Show episode 31. Thanks to Big Wayne and Reed for sitting in the studio and watching Anthony and I chat. The website's lazlow.com. You can download this entire show. It'll probably be posted tomorrow at some point. You can also get the box set of Wayne and Reed and their history in radio, where they actually talked more, but now they seem to be talking less. Thanks to Anthony for coming on the show.
Yeah, thanks, Laz, man. Always a pleasure.
And when we
thanks
do
for the beer.
I knew that would do it. And thanks to everybody. Thanks to Opie and Anthony for letting us do it. Have a good
anytime.
Night.
Anytime.
Thank you for listening to the Lazlow Show.
That show sucks my ass.
That's only in the moment. Because we are cooking breakfast or somebody.
I want nothing. I want my God and I want my family. She was here for the devastating stuff.
Hello?
It's Bob.
Hello.
Hi, it's Bob.
When we ate at Nathan's before, only my chair had a yellow balloon on it.
What are you talking about?
All right, kid. We did it! Woo! Kid? Kid, you all right? Come on, buddy, you all right? Can you hear me? Kid?
If I say yes, will you promise we'll never have to do that again?
Never say never, partner. Never say never.
Rocco in London, Rocco in Chicago, Discover Card. It pays to discover.
This concludes Saturday Night Virus.